and I have termites. Oh, it's terrible. And I'm
missing
it cost me thousands. Oh, it's awful.
Do you have termite insurance?
I know, but I pay $300 bucks a year, so the spraying is free. But the fixing isn't free. So the termites, you know, the whole back of the house, I mean, it's bad.
Yeah.
It's bad. It's going to be, you know, $2,000 or $3,000 bucks. It's terrible. So now I have another place next door, and everyone that rents these places, and I, you know, they just, money doesn't mean anything to them. They come down for 4 months, 5 months, and they just have money, right? So I had to go in there and make sure there were no termites where they were, right? And they may even be listening right now, because they said to me they listened. And I, but they don't say you're good. They didn't say I was bad. They just go like this. They see me. I'm sniffing around for termites. I'm looking all over the place for a termite. And they're very nice people. And they both.
What are you wearing when you're checking for termites?
Oh, I look like a camp counselor. I have like a. I had cut my arm on a piece of wood or something.
You have like a khaki outfit.
Yes,
you do.
Yes. I had khaki shorts.
With a cancer hat on, like, you know, so you don't get cancer of the face, you know.
I have that. I have that big cancer hat. That's right. And the sunglasses from the glaucoma surgery.
Yes.
I had the big sunglasses. And I've got shorts that have blood on them. And I have a Detroit Red Wings T-shirt on with the big, like, tire with the wing on it. And it's like, doesn't even make a statement. What am I wearing that for? Yeah. Oh no, it looks horrible.
Yeah.
Absolutely horrible. Yeah.
That's nice.
But then I just said, oh, like that. I went, oh.
Don't you ever think about just getting rid of some of these clothes that you have that you're traveling with?
And these are brand new clothes. These are brand new.
The Red Wings T-shirt is new?
I just bought that in Detroit. Yeah. That's yeah. But it doesn't say Red Wings. It just has the emblem, which I think is cool. Mm-hmm. And it makes me look like I'm moving even when I'm standing still because it's that wheel with with the thing on it.
All right.
And then, of course, I picked up a copy of the local paper here in Abita Springs, Louisiana. Which is Covington, Mandeville, you know, that area.
Metairie.
No, Metairie is somewhere else. But I wanted to take a look at some of the things that were happening. And they're having a prayer breakfast on Friday. It's the front page.
A prayer breakfast and gambling at the same time.
The Kiwanis Club organizing assembly. They're going to have a prayer breakfast. And this is you would think, well, and, you know, sadly, they're always burying people on the front page. This is the very front page of the Covington Picayune, which is the...
I never knew how to say that. It's Picayune? Is that how you say Picayune.
Dangers of medical mistakes discussed at the Life Tree Cafe.
Dangers of medical mistakes
will be discussed at the Life Tree Cafe.
What is this Life Tree Cafe?
I don't know.
All organic?
Christina, please Google the Life Tree Cafe in Covington, Louisiana.
Sounds very crunchy,
so,
isn't it?
But you're at the Life Tree and you're talking about death. You know what I'm saying? And here's the program.
Well, they cut my arm off.
Will you let me? You did it again. I was going to say the pro, and you know.
What are you going to say?
You know what? You don't listen, and I know your mother told you that.
I am listening.
No. You don't listen in life. That's why your wife left you.
Can you guys listen to this?
What?
Imagine a place where you can be you.
Yeah.
A place where you're welcome just as you are.
Really?
Your thoughts are welcome.
Probably the life.
Your doubts are welcome. A place that embraces your questions.
I hope I didn't ruin it for everybody.
What is this?
A place where people can openly talk about life and faith.
Wow.
A place where you can deal with the tough stuff in life.
Wow.
And where you can meet new and old friends. Welcome to Life Tree Cafe.
Ah, yeah!
Life Tree Cafe is a time and place where people gather to engage in one-hour host-led discussions. There's a new topic every week, ranging from serious to fun and quirky.
Oh.
You can come to talk, or simply listen. At Live Tree Cafe, you'll hear intriguing stories on film and have conversations that will provide help, support, and a listening ear for the things we all deal with in life.
All right, good.
Live Tree Cafe.
All right, thanks a lot.
You're welcome. Oh,
great. So that they're having that. They're going to be talking about Dr. Danger, mm-hmm. what every patient needs to know, and then a film by How Hospitals Kill People.
Do they have any examples of, like, you know, people that...
Oh, no, it's a wide-open deal. They'll talk about HIV. Mm-hmm. I mean, I found, actually, this is on the front page. So that's kind of a hit place.
Are you going to go?
No. This is the front page. Mm-hmm. North Shore Duplicate Bridge Club seeks players. This is the front page of the paper. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right next to somebody being buried.
Do you play bridge?
No, I hear it's very difficult. I don't play it.
My mom plays Terry.
Oh, there's a Jewish thing here. Wow. I mean, I'm really a little bit surprised. Spark a Reaction Teen Reading Program begins mm-hmm. for teens 12 to 18. You go in there and they you'll learn
just
about
for Jewish people.
No, this is it. I went off that. You Tuesday you learn about the science of ice cream. At 2:30. This is no. Wait, let me tell you what. You have a daughter. How old is your daughter?
I don't know.
No, 14. With your daughter, from 12 to 18, they're trying to, you know, get kids, you know, off the streets, mm-hmm. stop doing drugs. Interested?
I know.
Would your daughter go over to the Spark a Reaction Teen Reading Program to learn the science of ice cream?
No, she wants to hang out on the streets.
Yeah, Christina, can you imagine when you're 17 going over to the science of ice cream? Reading center?
Was there weed there?
No, there then would no. not be any.
Like, why would I want to go over there, Daddy? Why?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't want to go there, okay? Okay? You understand? I don't want to go there.
I want to go around the horn with you and Christina because in Covington, the Hosanna Lutheran Church is going to do something concerning quilts. Can you turn that music down a little bit? I'm getting a headache. wait a minute. I'll turn it down. Concerning quilts. I turned it down. Christina, and the clue is easy. The clue is, this sounds Catholic to me. Mm-hmm. What is it? Concerning quilts. Something Catholics love to do.
They're going to make a quilt out of the Eucharist.
Eucharist quilt.
You could get a needle and thread through there. I know you can.
Yeah.
They're disgusting.
The little wafer, they're going to make quilts out of the Eucharist wafer, or better known as the body of Christ. I don't think we're going to have a body of Christ quilt anytime soon in the area. But you know what? I'm going to put that into the hopper before I say yes or no. Is the lovely is it Carolyn? Was that her name?
Carolyn in the city. She's
the thin moon-headed Carolyn. Yeah. Carolyn, welcome to the show. What do you think they're going to do to quilts there at the Lutheran Church?
And set them on fire. The clue
is they'll set them on fire. Nice. Catholics like to burn stuff. I think they sometimes they burn the Quran sometimes just to get a. You know what? That they ought to actually move that over to Spark Reactions Teen Reading Program, where they offer the teens a chance to burn, you know, something. I think a lot of teens would show up. And Kevin, what's the big answer?
I would have to say, since this new pope, you know, him being
now this
so,
Lutheran, this is Lutheran.
I know, but it's all Christianity. I would say that it would be adding to the AIDS quilt.
Oh, adding to the AIDS quilt. Well, that was nice. Mm-hmm. Actually, you bring your quilt, and there's a picture here of maybe 200 quilts.
Yes.
And you drape the pews with unlimited quilts at the Hosanna Lutheran Church. There are no people. There are just quilts.
Yes.
For as far as the eye can see, mm-hmm. on the pews. And the minister blesses the quilt.
Oh, it's kind of like an AIDS quilt, though.
No, but the Catholics do that. The Catholics, they'll bless your throat, your dog, anything. But what's funny is it's in a church. There are no people.
Mm-hmm.
the guy is providing over textiles. Mm-hmm. It's okay. just quilts. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I do know what you're
You don't
saying.
Find that, you know,
I find it fascinating, yes. I'm totally fascinated with that.
Let's go to John, who's in Massachusetts. Yes, John, go ahead. What can we do for him?
Hey there. I was reading some articles about the Jared Remy case, Jared Remy, the son of Jared Remy who killed his wife.
Yes.
No, I don't know who that is. Who is that?
He killed his wife in front of his Jared Remy, like, he used to play for the Red Sox.
Oh, that's right. He's the announcer, right? Yeah. His son is the murderer.
Yeah. I guess there were, like, five cases where women had brought charges against him for beating him up. And each time Jared Remy had, like,
a... And she's still married. Now, wait a minute. This is before he was married?
Yeah.
Okay, I rest my case. I'm sorry she's dead, but I've said this about and to women many times. There are a lot of women that are stunned by what men do to them later on. But in my research and what I've read and seen, they say that over three-fourths of women that marry a guy who was abusive, he was abusive and showed signs of that, or there was evidence of that prior to them getting together. So I'm just going to say, cool, thanks a lot. She should have known better. Sorry, she's dead. Okay?
Yeah.
That's it. See you later. I have no idea. I don't know. See you later. Bye-bye. I don't know. I have no idea. That's too ridiculous to me.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
You know, how about I mentioned yesterday that the running back for the Ravens had knocked his girlfriend out cold, out like a light, like a mackerel.
Yes.
And she marries him.
Yes.
You know, and now she can't testify against him in court.
No.
Yeah.
No, I know. You can't.
That's the whole deal.
Yeah.
So the judge said, well, we're still going to do it.
Yeah.
You know, let's go to William of New York. Yes, William, go ahead.
Yeah, hello?
Yes.
Yeah, I listen to the show every once in a while, but I turned it on this afternoon,
mm-hmm.
and I heard you guys making fun of Lutherans.
Not exactly making fun, just saying that a church filled with quilts...
Yes.
And no humans, and then somebody, they show the minister presiding over the blessing of the quilts. It just looks odd to me that you were blessing, that you had a
and
church
Jay,
full
as
of...
as far as I know, I think we're allowed to make fun of Lutherans.
Hold on a second.
No.
It was a church full of... By the way, the quilts I was looking
Last
at...
Last time I checked.
The quilts I was looking at actually were as lifeless as most Lutheran congregations.
There we go, yeah.
Now
Jay
that's
Thomas.
Making fun
there you go.
Of a Lutheran.
Yeah.
I didn't say that before.
Yeah.
But now that you
nice.
Called William, I thought I'd add, you know, now you
Jay
have
Key.
A complaint.
Take
go
him
ahead.
Down.
Now you have a. I made fun. Go
yeah,
ahead.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Hey, well, it's not like we're taking up a collection for the air conditioning.
The Catholics take up a collection for air conditioning?
Oh, see? I didn't even say Catholic.
You didn't say Catholic.
But I assume that any Lutheran would make fun of a Catholic.
Yeah.
I mean, on his deathbed, on his deathbed, Martin Luther swore that he didn't mean to start a new religion. That's what I was taught at Jesuit High School. And so Martin Luther started the Lutheran and wanted to just have an order of priests that had some different beliefs. He didn't want a new religion. It had gotten out of hand. I don't know if you know that or not. So you live in a religion where the head guy who it's named after, on his deathbed, I'm not sure anybody was there but the couple of priests and the Pope or something. I don't know if his, you know, some of his breakaway Lutherans.
Well, you know what they say about those Episcopalians.
What?
Whenever you get four of them together, there's always a fifth.
Mm-hmm. It's like the Holy Ghost. It's like, you know, whenever there's three, there's a prayer circle or something like that, right?
Well, did you understand what he said?
I must have been mistaken. I'm sorry.
No, you know what? I've never had a Lutheran call. Right. I'm just so excited that there's any movement or blood enough for a Lutheran to call. Thank you. So anyway, that was sort of fun to read the front page. You know, it's amazing, isn't it, to wake up in a town and everything's kind of local, you know, and it's not, you know, some, you know, bombs blowing up or here, you know, Egypt or something. like that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You wake up, you pick up the paper, and on the front page, there's going to be a blessing of the quilts.
Mm-hmm.
What a life that would be, huh?
Well, that's...
Would you like to live that kind of life?
I do. I live up in the country. That's what my country house is all about. There's nothing going on up there. Absolutely
now,
nothing.
Will you ever move up there permanently and that's what you do?
I might start raising bees.
Really?
Yeah, that's a friend of mine talked to me about. I have a lot of land that I can, you know, I can have them all winter up there.
Yeah.
And, you know, you make pretty good money, you know, lending your bees out to farms so they can pollinate. And it's something I'm looking into.
Wow. It's time now for...
You look so hot in a beekeeper outfit.
Thank you.
Time now for Cool Barista.
Oh.
Cool Barista. Do we have...
Cool Barista.
Yeah. Coffee maker.
Cool Barista.
Yeah.
Oh.
Cool Barista.
Yeah. Ding, ding, ding.
Cool Barista. Attention, everyone in Chicago. A 48-year-old... Roscoe Village individual, Jim Carr, according to the Dark Matter Coffee Facebook page, Jim Carr, who is a barista at Dark Matter Coffee, was taking down a large coffee machine in the 300 block of East Jefferson Drive in Grant Park, lost his balance, tried to steady himself. The coffee machine fell on him and killed him at 4:56 p.m. Yeah. So Jim Carr, wow, unbelievable, who was a barista, was killed by a falling coffee machine. I know it's sad for your family, but I think it's really cool the way you died. All right, there we go. Cool Barista. The Jay Thomas Show is off and running. Stay where you are.
Yeah, yes.
Cool Barista. Yeah. Hit him with the Betty Yates.
I said, now the moment has finally come when I'm going to show you some of that cool shit. Now give me a little bit of drum by himself there.
Well, I know they have no feminine. You know what I'm saying?
We make you feel better about yourself.
It's the Jay Thomas Show.
Afternoon.
Sirius XM 104.
You're up.
I had mentioned last week about the woman who has a book out, and she was one of the women that was tortured and treated awfully for, 15 years in Cleveland by the guy Castro, who, did he die in prison, Christina? Did he kill himself?
No, he's still alive. He's
No, he's dead.
But his brother's running the country.
No, you idiot.
No, right?
No.
Like Raul. Raul is in charge
now. This is the kidnapper. Okay, so we've got. I didn't want to have her on.
They found him with a sheet tied around his neck in jail.
Oh,
in prison.
He was doing. What was he doing? A Ku Klux Klan thing?
No, he had terrible sleep apnea.
That's what I heard. His knees were bent. His shorts wrapped around his ankles.
Ooh. Hold on, that's what I looked like this morning when I went to visit the people next door. I just got up. Yeah.
Oh God, you had your.
I'm going to stop you for a second and tell you something terrible that happened, and I think I said this before.
I shouldn't be laughing. I'm sorry.
I was at the golf course late in the afternoon, and I see this guy walking, and I walk over to him. And he says, hey, would you like to join me? And I go, yeah. He says, I just play in the afternoon a few holes. I said, yeah, me too. I get some exercise, whatever, walking. And so we start talking, and he's a pilot for Delta Airlines. I still see him to this day. Mm-hmm. And he walks around, and he recognized me, said his mother had been and still is a character actress, and she's like in her late 80s or something. And gives me the shows she was on, and I think she might have starred in Perry Mason or something like that. Okay. I mean, you know, the secretary, whatever. And I said, wow, that's really cool. He goes, yeah, and I think his dad might have been a producer or whatever. And he goes on to tell me that he knew I was in radio and all of that, but he never listened to me. He's a big fan of Howard Stern's, huge fan.
Mm-hmm.
I said, oh, that's cool. I said, well, I'm on Sirius. So he goes, really? What number? And I, 104, and I tell him I'm on Sirius and everything else. And he's really a good golfer. And he's a pilot. And we walked for like 5 or 6 holes. And he was a nice person. He's a very nice person. Mm-hmm. And so he said, man, I'm going to, he just got married.
Oh.
And he was like, in his late 40s or something like that. And he was really nervous, so he gets married and everything else. And so we finished playing golf. And I guess I came on the air, and I must have talked about it and said he was boring or something. I don't remember. Like I'm talking about the people renting next door, right? Now, I mean it. I don't remember. I'm sure I made some joke, like a Lutheran joke or whatever.
Did he kill himself or something?
Wait a minute. No. I go back out to the course, and there he is. It's late in the afternoon, and there's no one around. And I guess he probably went out of his way. His wife might have been in the car, and he turns on 104. Now, he's a fan of Howard Stern, so I figure, you know, all bets are off. I can do what I want to do, and I probably did. I don't know what I said, but I probably made fun of him.
You said something about his big fat
head. Let me tell you what. When I saw him, I said, do you mind if I play with you? He goes, you know, I'm just kind of playing alone today, if that's okay. Like that. Which is odd, right?
Right.
And I said, oh. He says, yeah, I'm hitting a couple of balls. Why don't you just go ahead of me?
Yeah.
And it was very quiet and tense. And I said, hey, did you get a chance to listen to me? And he went like this. Yes, I did.
Yeah.
Just like that. And I went, and I got it. I realized what was wrong. I said something, and it's like the people next, they go, you know, I can't tell if it's a compliment or they're warning me that people listen. It was like they were warning, you know, we listen to your satellite radio show.
Somebody called the other day to complain.
No, but what I'm saying is there's a warning there, like, you know, I know you're talking about things, but people listen to you. Like that. Mm-hmm. And I would rather if you ever meet me, go, oh man, I listen to the show. You're funny. You know, Kevin's funny. It's Christine. You know, like that. But if you just go,
you're always supposed to compliment, you know, when
you acted. How about this one, Kevin? Mm-hmm. Hey, are you Kevin Meaney? I've seen you on TV. Mm-hmm. They stop.
Yeah.
That's it. You weren't good.
No.
You weren't bad. But
this is what
I
get after they see my show. Like, they'll see me live and they'll go, I got it. And, like, nobody else enjoyed it except them. And I was like, oh, thank you. Thank you very much. I got it. I know what you're trying to do. All right, thanks.
By the way, yesterday, Robert De Niro, that was big news. I didn't know anything about it. I knew his dad was an artist and, in fact, quite a famous artist, Robert De Niro Sr. And what's odd to me is that when you think about Robert De Niro, he was raised in a very intellectual family. His mom and dad were divorced. But he was not a tough guy from the streets, and yet he's really fantastic at playing it. Not that most Italians can't kind of bring that up in them, right? You know, we got that kind of, you know, mook thing going. But Andy, and he shows such incredible emotions. As soon as he made this confession, is there some sort of a show he was on, Christina? What was the platform that he all of a sudden outs his father, you know, being gay or to the world? You know, not that the community.
I read it in the it was in the New York Post, but I think it was because he did
he
a documentary.
Out magazine.
He did
what is it?
Out magazine. Mm-hmm. But he did.
He outed his own dead father.
No, he did a documentary on his father.
And on HBO, and it's called Remembering the Artist, Robert De Niro Sr.
So it tells of his whole life and who his dad was.
I don't think, I watched that, it doesn't talk about his dad being gay, does it? Maybe I went down and got something to drink when that was being told.
Yeah, maybe you went down when that was going on.
They did have a lot of shots of him chewing on the end of his brush. I wondered about that. And he would take the wooden end of the brush and kind of when he was thinking of what to paint, he'd lick the end of it.
Very gay.
He'd put it under his chin to think.
Wood?
Yeah.
Then I thought, well, this makes a lot of sense. Robert De Niro has some extra estrogen.
See,
in
you're
him.
You're like such a Monday morning quarterback, though. Like now you figured mm-hmm. it out. Yeah,
yes.
Now this makes perfect sense. First of all, I always knew his father was gay.
No, I didn't know that. Yeah. Here's the thing: not many, and I have trouble with it too. And yet, I do have some female characteristics. You know, I like to cook. I'm very clean. You know, and all this kind of stuff. The thing is that showing the emotions that certain actors
you keep
show,
your vagina lubricated,
especially males, it's very difficult. You know, people go, how do you cry in the movies or in the theater? How do you cry 7-8 times a week? Some of it you can do technically, but a lot of times you have to bring
in your ball and your pubes.
You have to, no, your nose, not your pubes.
How are you going to do that? You have to.
That makes you, what is that? It makes your balls hurt. You know what? You don't have any, so don't talk about them.
How do you know if I have pubes or not?
No, you don't have any balls. You were talking about your balls, weren't you?
No, like around, no, pubes.
Yeah, wow.
Why'd you set off your balls?
That's weird, Jay.
Pubes.
You tweeze your nose hairs to cry.
Okay, well, I thought that you could cut a hole in your pocket and just keep them in there, and then every time you needed
and
something.
Why would you cry? Why would you cry because you're...
Because it hurts.
Yeah, you don't cry because something hurts. You go, ow.
Well, let's try when to tweeze your pubes and see if you cry.
No, when you tweeze your nose, it activates a tear duct.
Yeah, I know that, Jay.
All right. Or you put glycerin in your eyes. Did you know that?
No, I didn't.
They take a shooter, you open your eyes really wide, and they blow glycerin in there, and it gets them going, and then you get the emotion. Anyway, Robert De Niro was always so good at that, I believe. Look, James Dean was totally gay and acted, you know, so wild. And then you go, well, of course, Rock Hudson. Yeah. Earl Holliman, one of my favorite actors. I mean, the man almost wore dresses, for God's sakes. You know what I'm saying? I think that allows you to play a tough guy, and then you got emotion. Robert De Niro is not gay, you know, but how about that emotion? I believe there's something to it.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I believe there's something to that.
I think you can teach this in your life acting course.
I would have to ask this question. Are any men in here, any of my male students, mm-hmm. do any of you have a homosexual very close in your bloodline?
Mm-hmm.
Like that. And they would go, my sister is a lesbian. Ooh, wow. That actually is worse for you.
You remember how Tony Danza did, you know, he went back and he did a teacher, you know, he became a teacher
Stupid.
For, you know.
I know.
This would be great for you. You are now, you're a seasoned actor, but you go back and you become a teacher and you are teaching your brand of acting, your life acting. And you'll go, how many people here have any homosexuality?
I want you to listen to this carefully. I want you to listen to this carefully. I have taught acting and in Denver, Colorado at an acting institute at UCLA, on the campus of UCLA. I was invited by, you know, acting at University of California at Santa Barbara, at Jacksonville University, and in, you know, many other little colleges. For a long time, I would be invited in, and there would be the little fresh-faced, you know, actors, right? Some had no idea who I was or whatever, and I would come in, and by the end of my session, the professor, the teacher, the woman, the man would go, well, that was a whole different take on...
But you can tell your stories about how you threw yourself on Mel.
All of it. And yeah, this one. Here's the other one.
Mel Gibson.
You know,
Mel Gibson. Mel.
You know, there's no room for any of us in any field. They always go, oh, there's no room for actors. Well, there's no room for doctors either. There's no room for lawyers and everything else. Here's the difference. A lot of lawyers are like actors who just stay and do community theater.
Mm-hmm.
They live in their little community, and they're a lawyer, and they make a living. And then there are these actors that do community theater, or they just always stay in this lower level. Mm-hmm. And here's the problem. If you want to be that big lawyer, that Supreme Court justice, let's say, you want to become the attorney general or whatever, that's the big-time acting.
Right.
And so when people say there's no room for actors, but they don't say it about lawyers and doctors, because all actors are trying to to get to the top. And so my first advice to you as an actor is, because a lot of lawyers just want to go back to their hometown and be lawyers. A lot of doctors want to go back to their community and help out. There's not a person in this room whose ego is not bubbling inside of them right now, and they expect to be at the top of the top and looking back down on the others.
Right.
I'd like someone to raise their hand here who's not thinking about getting to the top, no matter who they have to step over to get there. I do that. That's the kind of ruthlessness you don't have with others, but you have to have that ruthlessness with yourself. You have to be so hard on yourself. Like, you don't make fun of others. You don't say anything about them. But when you screw up, you must be so hard on yourself that if anybody heard how hard you were, they would actually stop you from saying that to yourself.
Mm-hmm.
At the end of this thing, all the professors always go, well, I don't know that I agree with a lot of the things that are being...
Well,
I mean, it's the way to do it.
Generally,
it's the way to do it.
Have a little bit more fun in acting than...
Yes,
that,
I know.
Jay.
No. If you know what you want, if you raise your hand and go, yeah, I really just want to be a community theater person, well, God love you. That's fine. But have you ever met an actor in an acting class who just wanted to work out at the YMCA every now and again? No. Actors are barracudas. Disc jockeys or talk show hosts, they don't want to be in, you know, Sacramento. They want to be on national TV.
You know, as an actor, you do anything. Mm-hmm. So, like, you just don't do musical theater. You do straight acting. You do commercials. You do television. You do movies.
Right.
You do modeling. You do radio. You do any stand-up comedy. Anything to keep you busy and to make you money. You know, that's
you will throw all of those against a wall, and one of them will stick.
Right.
And you are just as excited by the success of a voiceover as you are of getting a movie.
Absolutely.
And you know what's funny? I don't think they teach the economics. Listen, they don't teach the NFL or the baseball players or the basketball player kids what to do with millions of dollars. They should teach actors, singers, and dancers how to live on nothing.
Mm-hmm.
They really ought to. They ought to, like, go, look, you know, 95% of all actors are out of work 95% of the time. It doesn't mean that you can't make it, but you're either going to have to marry somebody or hook into some job or something and make some money if you even want to buy new pairs of shoes every now and again. Oh, people hate hearing that. So I'm glad you brought that up.
You're welcome.
By the way, Phil Robertson of Duck Dynasty, the man that, of course, didn't believe in, what, gay marriage or got in a little trouble, and then a groundswell of popularity brought him back. He will be addressing the Republican Leadership Conference. In fact, he's doing it tonight at 6 p.m. So here's a guy that came out and made statements and said he doesn't believe in homosexual marriage and all that, and he gets in trouble. They suspend him, and then the groundswell of popularity, they put him. So here's a guy that said, you know, something against the whole group of individuals.
Yeah.
And the governor of Louisiana will be there, and the governors of
you know who's going to be
Mississippi,
there also?
Texas.
Donald Sterling's going to be there.
Ted Cruz. Donald Trump is going to be there. Newt Gingrich. All these people are going to be there, and they're going to hear the Duck Dynasty idiot with the beard. Not because he said that about gays, but what's he doing talking to the...
A prophet. He's a total...
It's like Al Sharpton talking to a liberal leadership.
But he has become... Group. They call him the prophet now. He has actually become bigger than who he ever thought he could be, you know, because
the
of...
The prophet.
But because of, you know, the things that he has said over the last few years, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's really changed his life. He's not a big drunk anymore, and he loves Jesus.
I heard that recently over last weekend they had Red Fest in Austin, and he had a whole auditorium film. He did a sermon on Sundays, and it was packed to the brim. So,
yeah, he is, they call him the prophet, don't they?
Yeah, I think
well, here's the deal. That must make you and your ilk feel mighty bad.
No, it doesn't. It's
the prophet.
It
makes you feel bad for the people that follow him. Not really.
Christina, that is like, 150 million Americans.
I know, but...
200 million Americans.
I know, but, I mean,
285 million Americans.
They're wrong.
Close to 300 million
all
Americans.
Equally human people. You know,
they're like, all really. Wrong, Jay.
Yeah.
They're wrong.
Only,
they're
wrong. Only at a liberal outlet like this. Only a liberal outlet like this. That's all. You in the street, lots of people are against
it. And I bet half of them that are there are probably gay and are just in closeted, you know?
Oh, really? You're one of those? They're gay. Winklevoss Radio. I didn't even know we had that. Those are the twins that, helped start Facebook. I don't want to make a comment. I don't know them. Tonight, veteran Silicon Valley startup lawyer. Tim Harris will tell you how to do a startup.
Mm-hmm. Oh. Okay.
Tomorrow night, they're having Lena Dunham on.
Success without stress.
And Lena Dunham, the 26-year-old completely emotional wreck, is going to talk about that.
It's like
you don't think a 26-year-old, incredibly successful girl.
And then you think that the person acting in it is that way in real life. But you're an actor. You should know that that's not true.
Well, she's going to talk about transcendental meditation.
Right, with Bob Ross.
Yeah. Here's the thing. She's fabulous. She's a writer, director, and she acts in the thing. No one I've ever met like that. Kevin, back me up.
What
at that young
this?
Age.
Girls. Like
girls.
Oh, girl.
She's 26, writer, director, producer, and actress. Everyone at that age who is that successful is a nervous, neurotic wreck. And that's what the show is about, too, which she admits. Mm-hmm. They're going to have her on there talking about success without stress. That's ridiculous. She ought to go on there and say, look, I'm a hyperactive, completely maniacal, you know, claw to the top.
She might have said that. You don't know. You'll have to check out the show to find out.
I doubt she said it.
Well, she's there to meditate.
You don't know.
So obviously there's something that she wants to get to the core of.
I mean, Jerry Seinfeld,
I'd like
we
to
had
go
that
on
guy
there.
On the air not too long ago about meditation. Yeah. And and I both agreed that would probably be good for us, you know. But
not anymore. I was just saying that.
He only says that because he's interviewing.
You know what I would like to do? I would like to have tonight Jay Thomas on Winklevoss Radio talks about
burning every bridge you possibly
can. No, here it is. You ready for this? How to turn hatred into success.
Huh? How to turn a cauldron of hate into success.
How to turn a cauldron of hate into success. I kept saying that. I was filled with a cauldron of hatred. You know, we listened to that satellite radio show of yours. And I'm there with a screwdriver in my hand. Really? Thank you. That's like when I dropped off a DVD of an audition, and the Icelandic director that was renting my house went to the house manager and said, "Can you believe it? The handyman gave me his audition tape. Can you believe it?" Yeah, the handyman. His wife was this beautiful model, and I said, "Oh, hi. Are you? Is it okay? The doorbell is stuck. Can you fix the doorknob?" I go, "The doorknob is, yes, right away." Let's fix the doorknob.
Oh, my God.
Let's go to Bruce's in Canada. Yes, Bruce, go ahead.
How's it going, Jay?
Yeah, we're good.
The thing about Bill Robertson and what he's preaching, he is not preaching that he hates gays. He preaches against homosexuality, like he preaches against premarital sex, like he preaches against theft. Like he preaches
I'm going to tell you, Bruce, right now, you can be against it all you want to, but your children and your children's children won't ever say that. The homosexual thing now is exactly what blacks went through when I was a kid. And they had guys that would call radio stations just like you and say, "Hey, man, he doesn't hate blacks. He was just saying that blacks are doing things that we really shouldn't be condoning." Bruce, I'm telling you, it's bullshit talk. You can't do that. You just, it's over.
I had to leave my church because I walked in there and I told the pastor that I couldn't be Christian because to be Christian, I had to learn how to hate and judge people. So I'll just...
Well, that I agree with. I like that, actually. Where church is that? I'll go to that church. But you can't hate a group of individuals.
Wasn't that the Satanist that we had on?
You, I'll tell you something,
yeah.
Bruce.
Yeah.
I think a room full of uptight white men, squares, total squares, bothers me 10 times more than a room full of homosexuals. I would have more fun with the homosexuals than the uptight square guys. That I've never understood. Why don't we say, if you're an uptight, square, right-wing voting male, you should be, we shouldn't just stay away from you. Because I stay away from those assholes. I stay as far away from them as I can. I can't stand them.
See, that's what you're doing. You're just turning the hatred around. Let it go, man. I don't hate anybody. It's not worth 1 minute of my lifetime to hate someone.
Oh, stop. You opened up with about the homosexual thing. You're one of those, like that grand dragon who calls up and goes, well, you know, we're not against blacks, but you're the grand dragon of the KKK, for Christ's sakes.
I'm just telling you what the guy said. I didn't say I agreed with him. I just said that.
Well, we don't need to hear that report. You sounded like you agreed with him.
Well, why would I?
I think you do agree with him, and I think in the middle of this you changed your speed so you'd stay on the air more. Get rid of him. Get rid of him. Completely rid of him. He disgusts me.
Yeah. How dare he?
Let's go to Matt, who's in South Carolina. Yes, Matt, go ahead.
Hey, can you hear me?
We can hear you now, yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Hey,
is that really good?
I guess you guys are off on a different tangent now, but I just wanted, you're talking about funny things on the front of small-town newspapers.
Yes, yes. Where do you live? What small town do you live in, Matt, in South Carolina? Do you live in Greenville?
No, way south, real close to basically Savannah.
Savannah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it's in Beaufort County, but on the cover of the newspaper, the lady basically, she called the city police department because her neighbor put the root on her and made her ankles swell, and her neighbors fall out of their chairs.
You mean she voodooed them, she put some black magic on them.
Wow.
Yeah.
And
those are probably people who have Creole blood in them. And they were probably their ancestors were born out on those islands out there off of South Carolina, where they still speak that English brogue that they learned from pirates. That's true.
Yep. Go ahead, Geechee.
Have you ever read the book Conrack, Matt?
No, I have not.
Go out of your way. Read the book Conrack and then call me back with a report. Thank you, Matt, very much. Thank you. Thank you. Conrack. Unbelievable. It's about those islands out there. What did Seth Rogen and spoiler alert, Seth Rogen and Snoop Dogg have done something about Game of Thrones, Christina?
Yeah, hold on. I got to find it.
What were you? Hello, Christina? What's going on?
She's looking
What's
for
What's happening? Oh. Apparently they got stoned.
Oh, dear.
And they did a wrap-up. You know what's funny about the pot thing now? I mean, just like a year, like 2 years ago, major stars wouldn't be smoking on video and stuff. You know what I mean? Yeah, they would talk about it, but because of these laws that are being passed, you know, and
I never
inhaled. You know,
I never inhaled.
But you know what? People don't have cocktails in their hands. You know what I'm saying? It's weird.
It's opened up quite a bit, you know.
But I think when you get stoned and you're driving, or if you're addicted to being stoned like every day, mm-hmm. I think that's just as bad as drinking.
I really do.
I know. Why is that? Why don't people? I put pot in the same category with any other imbibement.
And
what?
You shouldn't.
Of course you have to.
No, you
you're stoned, you're stoned.
No, you shouldn't put pot into that kind of a category.
I think if you have, like, if you've been drinking and driving, mm-hmm. I think that's really bad. Okay.
If you're stoned and driving, it's really bad.
No, stopped at the stop sign for extra long.
I don't.
No,
think it,
you're
I don't
not.
Think
you can't make
bad.
A decision. You're crazy.
Oh,
no,
I don't
I'm
think
not
it's.
Crazy.
I don't
it's
think it's half as bad.
No.
That is ridiculous.
No,
that is totally ridiculous.
No. It's not ridiculous.
I'd rather
no.
have a high driver than a drunk driver.
Mm-hmm.
No, you wouldn't. Stoned is stoned.
There are people that
booze,
that take,
poke,
no,
all
there
of
are
it.
People that smoke and then they function throughout an entire day and can do every single thing. Sometimes it motivates them if they work in a creative atmosphere.
But their brain is not working properly.
What do you mean it's not working properly? Of course it is.
It's not complete.
But so can an alcoholic. Look at the Denzel Washington in flight.
Well, that's true, eventually. But
because
I'm saying,
he did that plane upside
well,
down.
Well, once the plane turns upside down. Can I be honest?
Yeah.
Once the plane turns upside down, I've never met a drug addict or an alcoholic who didn't sober up in a horrifying tragedy.
Yeah.
Right or wrong?
Oh, yeah, you sober up.
I have been loaded. Yeah. I have been stoned. And when I come in, my wife has just found out something horrible about me that I have to deal with. I'm no longer stoned, drunk, or whatever. I'm completely sober. So that's like the plane turning over in the movie Flight, okay?
Yeah.
You get home, and your wife's going to put a corkscrew up your ass for something that you did. You're no longer stoned.
That's
you're no longer stoned. Yeah. Let's go to Samantha, who is in Massachusetts.
Oh, Samantha.
Hello, Jay. How are you?
I'm perfect.
Oh, good. Well, I was calling to ask for a photograph of you, autographed for my husband as a birthday present for him. He's a big fan.
All right. You know what? Just, you know, yeah, send me your address to jthomasshow@gmail.com. Thanks. Don't do this on the air. This is, you know, like.
Well, he told me not to call because he said if you called.
You know what? Why don't you call that guitar pick guy? That guy's getting out of hand. That guitar pick thing. What is that about? Christina, send him a note. Said Jay would like you to, you know, if you're going to keep selling his likeness on a guitar pick, you know, how about a cut?
All right. Yeah, sure. I'm sure he's listening right now.
Well, how about a cut? All right. Samantha, Jay Thomas Show at Gmail.
Is burning right now.
All right.
What else is new?
All right. There you go. Let's go to Jeff, who's in Colorado. Yes, Jeff, go ahead. Jeff, do you like people driving around there stoned in Colorado? You think that's okay?
Well, yeah, I pretty much do it all the time. So
really?
I can't really judge. And I drive a lot better stoned than I do when I'm not stoned.
Oh, you do? Oh, you're much better stoned? I see.
Yes.
I think most people that, you know, do smoke pot, I think they would, it is much easier. It's much better to drive, you know, after you've
you,
had a
you
couple
really
of
are.
Joints.
I hope you're kidding. Because you really, this is bad.
I know it sounds bad, but it's the truth.
It's
it
no,
is
it
the
doesn't.
Total truth.
It's,
it is.
No, it's not.
You're just
of
a little too
I'm
old,
kidding.
Jay.
Yeah, sometimes
no.
I'm just a little nervous.
No, I do not get behind the wheel of a car if I'm impaired. I don't like, I mean, it's like a leaf goes
do
by.
You
and,
get
oh,
behind,
a cow!
You
oh,
get,
I almost hit a cow!
Do you get
and
in
you,
the car,
oh, you are so
do
paranoid.
Do you get in the car with somebody else that's impaired? Don't lie.
I have no
ever,
idea.
Yeah.
Have you ever driven across Utah?
Yes, I have.
Stoned, yes.
Stoned?
Well, you have to be. You have to be stoned when you're driving
you're
cross country.
You're on the moon.
Yeah. I remember I drove cross country with a female friend of mine, and every time we crossed state lines, we did a line of coke, and we took a couple of puffs, and we called it tumbleweed. What do we call it? State line. We did a state line and tumbleweed. That's what we did. All the way across the United States.
I think
so
the,
we'd go from Kansas
listed,
into Colorado or whatever. We'd go state line and then tumbleweed. Oh, yeah.
Hey, tumbleweed Thomas, I think that the defense rests after
all
that.
All right, Mike. I mean, Jeff, thank you very much. Thank you, Jeff, very much. All right, that's it. Let's listen to Rogan. I mean, no, not Rogan.
Seth Rogan.
Yeah, Seth Rogan and Snoop Dogg.
Four more years. I know, Seth, you watch
Stone.
I do watch Game of Thrones.
I just watched it last night.
For the first time?
So no. I watched the whole series.
Now. It's great.
Yeah. The little midget.
Questions.
They keep saying that. Because he was in love with a whore.
Yeah.
So he fucked around and they was going to give him some, his father was going to hook him up, but he was like, he couldn't shut his ass up. So now he's going to have to fight this big ass, gigantic motherfucker who his sister, the queen, wouldn't got. Because he killed, think he killed Joffrey. Yeah. They think he killed Joffrey, but he didn't kill Joffrey. Peter killed Joffrey.
Fucking, what's his name? Littlefingers.
Yeah, Peter.
Yeah.
And he's got...
You should do a weekly Game of Thrones.
Lily.
The HBO should put that on before every episode.
My shit, man.
This is Seth Rogen's laugh.
Fuck with the Game of Thrones. That's my shit.
I'd watch the shit out of that. Wow. Someone did a super cut.
One woman. Only one.
Pizza.
Now, are they at a voiceover session?
Ooh,
no,
damn.
It's like a.
Oh, bitch, get out the way. Get out the way. Pizza.
You know, sometimes it's the simple things that work.
I've only loved one woman my whole life. Your sister.
Move, bitch.
I think that's how they originally had that edited, actually.
That's data. Would you ever be in one of those kind of movies?
A Game of Thrones type shit? Yeah, sure. Why the fuck not? Would you?
I'd love to do that shit, to be a motherfucking king or something. Or even to be a fucking gladiator, a warrior. Yeah.
There's not a lot of black dudes on Game of Thrones, is there?
Is there one?
Is there one?
One or two of those Unsullied, maybe.
Wow.
Guys, the Unsullied guys.
Kevin.
That's great.
There you go.
It's good luck. Oh, man, that's got to be the greatest feeling in the world. Yeah. Top of the world, stoned, who gives a shit? I love those guys.
Yeah. I love them.
That's the top right there.
Jay Thomas.
The Jay Thomas Show.
It's the afternoon show.
It could be funny, too.
That was a good one. Say it twice. It could be funnier.
The Jay Thomas Show.
Indy. Sirius XM 104.
I'm talking with Charles Ramsey. He's a neighbor. Walk me through again what happened this afternoon.
I knew something was wrong when a little pretty white girl ran to a black man's arms. Dead giveaway. Dead giveaway. My neighbor got big testicles because we see this dude every day. We eat ribs, we just do. But we getting bad and blue. If that girl was in that house, she said, please help me get out.
Then give away, then give away.
So, that guy, Ariel Castro, that kept these women for how long? How many? Well, let's go to Charles. Charles, welcome to the show. How are you? Go to CharlesRamseyWorld.com. Thanks for being here. And,
it's an honor to talk to you, Charles.
Wow, that's Christina. It's an honor.
It is.
An honor. Wow. Now, Charles, you were at the McDonald's, and of course, you're going to eat McDonald's for the rest of your life, I understand, for free.
No.
Misunderstanding. That's a rumor? Oh, they should definitely hook you up, man.
How could they not take that back from you?
They covered their tracks by saying we'll be in contact.
Awful.
We'll be in contact.
Yeah, that's another reason why I will never eat at McDonald's.
You should boycott McDonald's.
I'm with you. I don't blame you. If I said I just left Red Lobster, what were they going to do? Give me Red Lobster for life?
They should.
Yeah.
You're a hero.
You know, I appreciate it, but, you know, a pat on the back and saying good job for what you did is cool. As opposed to come on now.
Oh, so you're okay with it. You're not mad at McDonald's.
No, of course not.
I'm a little mad at McDonald's.
I am.
Well, you know what? What I wish was if you don't want it, I'll take it.
Right, I hear you.
You know what I'm saying? It's transferable. Now, your new book, Dead Giveaway, which is the last word you said, the rescue, hamburgers, white folks, and instant celebrity. What you saw on TV doesn't begin to tell the story. So what is the story behind the story? You lived in the neighborhood, this kind of ramshackle house. The guy was a kidnapper, and nobody knew that he had these young women in there and was raping them and aborting children, all kind of horrible shit in there. What did you think of that house before you heard the woman screaming?
It was a record house. He's a record dude with a record job. You know, he didn't need a green card because he was born in the United States.
Right.
He did exactly what any other American would do. You know, he sold drugs. I didn't know about it. Who cares? That's not the issue. The issue is he did what he had to do, and he also did what he had to do to keep me and the neighbors from ever breaking into the house or ever having a reason to just pry on his neighbor on his property or whatnot. He kept us at bay, if you will.
Is that how, is that with the barbecues and the friendly, you know, hellos and everything, that's how he kept you guys?
The dude, some yard equipment come up missing one day. So he comes to me and he sees me outside. He says, listen, now, I got to go to work at 5:00 in the morning. I don't have time to be monitoring my house. You don't go to work until 4:00 in the afternoon. I said, yeah, so? He said, so listen, when you wake up, I'm sure you wake up around 10:30, 11 o'clock. I said, yeah, so? He goes, listen, do me a favor. Can you watch my property? Now, I just moved in that neighborhood, and I'm his neighbor. So for him asking me to do that, I took it upon myself and made it a personal crusade. Because here's the neighbor that I don't want to be a thorn in his side, trusting me with watching his property.
Yeah.
Wow. You get that? That's sure. called aiding and abetting by deception.
Is Did he pay you any money for that?
No, he's okay. asking to be a good neighbor.
All right, I thought maybe he'd throw you a sawbuck or something and watch your property every month, you know.
So, Charles, that was a compliment to have for him to ask you to watch your home, right?
In modern times, yeah.
Yeah, sure. Well, it makes you think he's got nothing to hide, so he's not. Yeah.
We were in the good old Western days, and I would expect it a sawbuck, but since we're in 2014, you know, you just do it because you do it.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Now the strange. So there he was in the house, and until that day, you'd never heard any. I mean, he was beating these women. He had them chained. You never heard. Did you ever hear any female voices coming out of the house?
Not one. That. Listen, wow. Asked Amanda before I got her out of the house. I gave her the third degree because I didn't know who she was. And if you got in there, surely you can get out. And first of all, who the hell are you? Because I know this dude. Well, I think I do, but I never saw you before. And if you got a girlfriend, we surely would know you. You're young and white. He's old Puerto Rican. They don't mix.
Yeah, and she's running into a black man's arms.
Needless to say.
Yeah, that's your famous line. That's your, you know, I knew something was wrong when a little pretty white girl ran into a black man's arms, dead giveaway. Thus the book, the music, everything. Yeah. Unreal. And what made you believe her?
Well, I didn't. That's why we called the cops. If I believe her.
Oh.
Please.
Where was Ariel Castro when she ran out screaming to you? Was he at work?
No, he wasn't there.
Mr. Castro's at McDonald's, I think. That's where they arrested him.
McDonald's? Everybody's at McDonald's.
This damn McDonald's, I got to tell you. Everybody who's anybody in that neighborhood hangs out. So they go and arrest him. And then now Amanda's written a book. Have you gotten a chance to talk to her? She's got full tats now, and she's got a lot of piercings and stuff. She's a pretty screwed-up kid, right?
No, she's not screwed up.
Charles answer, please? Let Charles answer. What? What's that?
Yeah, are you talking about Amanda or Michelle? What female?
Michelle.
Oh, Michelle, I'm talking about. Yes, yeah. Michelle. Yeah. Yeah, she seems screwed up. Charles?
Yeah.
She seems a little screwed up. I mean, I would be too, you know?
And that'd be an understatement then. Of course you'd be. If I kidnapped you and beat the hell out of you and rape you, you want to come out normal, go get a job and deal with society? Your adaptation is a little bit stronger than the average human, wouldn't you say?
Yep. Well, that would be true of me.
I don't think she's screwed up, though. I think she's dealing with it really well, and I think she's...
Yes, she is. She's not in a psych ward. She hasn't committed suicide. So, look, she's tougher than us.
Well, I'll tell you what I like about you. CharlesRamseyWorld.com in the book that's called Dead Giveaway, The Rescue Hamburgers, White Folks, and Instant Celebrity, and what you saw on TV doesn't begin to tell the story. You're a man. I mean, you just speak your mind. Was it hard for you to write this book? I mean, when you sat down, I'm in the midst of trying to write a book. Now I haven't written one word. But it's difficult just to sit down. And how many pages is the book?
165. It was 400, but they had to X those out because they were swear words.
I see. So there were 335 or 235 pages of curse words.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
I would like to read that.
So I guess that'll be my second book coming out.
It better be, Charles. It better be.
What's the title of that? Fuck it?
right. Exactly.
Fuck it, motherfucker.
I'm just going to fucking say it.
Yeah. Hey, motherfucking bitch. You know, wow. So they edited it, and when they handed back to you, did you feel as though that the book you really wanted to put out had been compromised? But you know, you got to kind of do what the money people say. You know.
No, I do it my way. That's why I came up.
Wow. Wow. Okay. I can't wait.
Good for you.
All right. Say it again. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I said I'm a Republican, so if you read the book, you'll figure out that my intelligence level is kind of high.
Wow. So it says you're a subject of a video game and T-shirts, but you didn't give your permission. What's
that with a lawsuit?
Wonderful, wonderful. So how do you feel being a celebrity? What's it like now?
I don't know. It hasn't come to me yet. What's it like helping some girls out being dire straits?
Yeah.
But when you walk down the street, do people stop you? Do they want to take your picture? Do they want to congratulate you or thank you?
All of the above, sugar.
Sugar. Oh, I love you, Charles Ramsey.
Ditto.
I really do. Girl.
Now, your cell phone filled up with so many text messages that you threw it in the river. What river did you throw the cell phone in?
Hudson.
Threw it right in the Hudson.
Oh, yeah.
Wow. Wow. Do they charge you for text messages? Was it going to be a horrible charge? Why'd you throw the phone in the river?
No, I threw it in the river because I received a phone from Pakistan. And since I couldn't understand Pakistani, I figured, yeah, well, enough's enough. First, I got bombarded from Australia. You could pretty much, read between the lines. They like to say absolute a lot. So
yeah,
I got to figure that. And then when the Philippines called, well, I don't speak Filipino, so I don't know what they were saying. And then Iran called, then China called, then Libya called, Syria called. You get the picture?
Yeah, I got you. Wow.
Wow, you're international.
American English speaking people called my phone. There we go.
Wow. Now, it says here you were flown to New York, but somebody didn't buy you a ticket back home to Cleveland. That seems hard to believe.
I believe I've been interviewed by a national television station before.
And wait a minute. You were interviewed, but they didn't give you a return ticket back to Cleveland?
Nope. Now, keep in mind, I said this in my book, and I've also said this on the Sean Hannity TV show. So that's national TV.
Mm-hmm.
So if I'm lying or fabricating this, they have yet to come forth and clear it up. Don't you think they want to clear it up?
Well, I've never heard of anybody flying a regular citizen or even a celebrity. Really? When you said, how do you expect me to get back home, what did this television show say?
Well, they told me that before I left Cleveland. See, that was my ass being gung-ho. See, I was told, now listen, we want this exclusive interview. Now, you can do it in Cleveland, but you won't be on national TV. We'll do it FaceTime or Skype or some way of technology. But
yeah,
if you come to New York City, we'll put you up in the hotel room. We'll give you spending money. You get to see Times Square, Central Park, and all the other landmarks. What do you say?
Yes.
I said, well, that sounds grand. Now, keep in mind, I just ended the conversation with, what do you say? See, they didn't say. And after the interview, we'll take you on back to the good old New Jersey turnpike over there, the Lincoln Tunnel, and fly you out of LaGuardia, and you're going back to Cleveland. They ended it with, what do you say?
Wow. And then when you got there, you realized you had a one-way ticket to New York. Will you tell us which show this is?
Cynthia McFadden.
Oh, how dare she?
Who? No, Cynthia cool. McFadden?
Cynthia McFadden, yeah.
Who is that? From what channel?
I've seen her on.
Well, what channel is that?
That's NBC Network, I believe. Or ABC.
Ridiculous. Really, it's the dumbest thing I've ever heard. But that's good. It's in the book, and everybody knows that Cynthia McFadden is an asshole.
Yeah.
I don't really blame her. I blame her handlers, because she didn't have anything to do with the interview. The first place.
McDonald's should have flew you back.
Hey, Charles, let me tell you something, Charles. Your handlers are going to make some mistakes, but let me tell you who is going to have to take the brunt. It's going to be Charles Ramsey. Let me tell you a little bit something about notoriety. And if what's her name, Cynthia? What's her name,
Cynthia
Kevin?
McFadden.
If Cynthia McFadden's handlers did it, let me tell you something. It lands on her big fat ass, okay?
I hear you.
All right. Is Charles Ramsey not responsible for what his representatives sometimes do in his name?
Well, yeah, you're right. It's going to fall back.
I'm schooling you, my friend, on celebrity.
Right. You're right. I told you. That's why when you ask me how it feels to be one, I don't know, because I ain't one yet. You know what I mean?
Yeah. You know what? And all these people, my handlers, nope. You know what? They're only talking about you. TMZ is only chasing you. They're not chasing your handlers down the street. Right.
So
go ahead, Christina.
What do you want to do next? Because now you have this platform and you wrote a book. What's next for Charles Ramsey?
Clean up my city. Now, I don't want to be the mayor, but I'd like to help him out. Now, I don't care about potholes. I don't care about crime. You take care of that. What I do care about is I don't want to see abandoned houses still standing after the city of Cleveland don't want to do nothing and or the landlord who owns that property. So we got two entities. They could care less if that's a playground for a pedophile. I don't want to see any more abandoned buildings. If we're not doing anything with it, demolish it. Now, I'm not trying to make my city a parking lot. What I'm going to do is the word refurbish comes into mind. So they say we're poverty stricken and we don't have any jobs. Okay, well, I shall create some.
Well, that's great.
Wow.
And what happened to the house of Ariel Castro? Is that still standing?
Oh, no, that's demolished. Yeah, they demolished it. That's a memorial now. It's like a flower bed. It's got a, let's say a walking track. What I mean by that is where his house and the house next door stood was big enough that you could make someone like a little park. Now, there's no swings, no fountains, but it's like you can walk through it with your dog or kids or whatnot. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Is it named for you, Charles Ramsey?
Say it again, bro.
Is it named for Charles Ramsey, you, that park?
No.
But it ought to be.
No, I appreciate it.
It ought to be.
It's cool.
Yeah. No. All right.
So, that is in my... Well, all as well, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, I'm looking at some of the, the table of contents here of your book. You talk about the media madness. You talk about the beginnings. One of them is higher education. How high have you gone in school?
Let me see. I think I got a GED.
GED? Right,
yeah,
okay.
I'm 15 and went to college. So.
Oh, you did?
I got like about... You see, 3 years of college education, but at the mm-hmm. age of 16, was the equivalent to nothing, because at 16, what kid do you know that's not a child prodigy that has discipline? Not me. I'll just beat the system. I chose to graduate. The way I figure, if I get kicked out the ninth grade and I get a mm-hmm. GED, instead of going to 10th grade, I'll be what? There you go. A freshman in college.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
True.
And then you went in the military. What branch of the military were you in?
U.S. Army.
Wow. Did you fight anybody? Did you go oversee any action?
No. I got out of there when my unit was getting ready to be deployed to Desert Storm in Kuwait.
Wow.
I got out of there in 3 weeks. They said, well, you don't want to go to war. I said, are we actually going to get to kill anybody over there that has anything to do with why we're going? Or are we going to war because the government wants you to go to war?
Mm-hmm.
So since they didn't give me a pertinent information, or enough information that was pertinent, rather, I chose to get out of there.
Well, this book you've got, is it?
I'll re-enlist.
Yeah, this book you have, I'm feeling it now, is so much more than just about Charles Ramsey and this rescue.
This is going to be a movie.
No, you're making some real statements about life. I mean, you've announced you're a Republican, which is amazing. I wouldn't expect you to be a conservative person. And now the military, how you got out of high school at 16 years old. There's a lot more to Charles Ramsey than just a guy who accidentally caught a white girl in his strong black arms.
I appreciate it. Thank you. But I'm just like anybody else. I'm a dishwasher. You know what I mean? Was a dishwasher.
No, you're not.
A humble dishwasher.
No, you're not. The dishes you wash are made of gold, my friend.
I loved washing dishes when I washed dishes.
I wasn't going to leave a woman and die straight. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Right.
Unbelievable.
Well,
hey, by the way.
Thank you, Charles.
Did you have to beat the door down? I mean, how did you, the other two girls just came out, or did you have to actually start beating on the door?
Police. No, hell no. They were locked up. In the basement or wherever he had them. No, that door was, it's got my DNA written all over it. Now, it's kind of funny. Let me tell you what's funny, right? Because you got DNA, but you got two types. You got mine, and you got a man to bear, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But but there's a third person, Mr. Angel Cordero. Well, how can you be the hero if your DNA isn't on the door? So what you expecting, what you help her do?
You're talking about the guy that was kind of across the street, and he really didn't do much, but took all the credit, or took a lot of the credit.
Well, he didn't take any, because I'm a national hero, and...
Well, that's right, but in his own head.
This is Angel Cordero, that's the guy's name?
Oh, yeah.
Well, Angel Cordero is also the name of a famous jockey. He's not a was he a little tiny guy, like in Game of Thrones? Is he about that height?
Peter.
Yeah, he's like Peter Dinklage. He may be Angel Cordero, the famous jockey. I haven't heard his name in a long time. That's unbelievable. So this, by the way, the first thing I would do with Angel Cordero is check his green card.
He doesn't have one, bro. Listen, let me tell you something.
Wow.
I was on TV with Anderson Cooper, and I said, he says, "What do you? There's reward money. So what do you want to do with it?" I said, "You give it to some girls, and then I pull it.
Wow.
All right.
Girls.
Now, 4 hours later." Mr. Angel Cordero comes on national TV, well, local, because you're not picking up for national. You come on local and you say, well, he didn't do anything. Wait a minute, I don't speak English. So I'm going to tell her what I did, and she's going to translate. Okay, that might work in Puerto Rico or Dominican Republic. This is America, so you need somebody like a witness. You need somebody that's with a pulse. Oh wait, there is one. Her name's Amanda Berry. She's breathing the whole nine yards. Oh, and she's speaking English, so you don't have to go get Rosetta Stone for her. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Have you been in contact with Amanda Berry? Do you talk to her often or no?
Often. I mean, you know, we don't talk on the phone or whatnot. I mean, she can't talk on the social network, so we chit-chat when we see each other in the street. You know what I mean? Like, she might be over at a mutual friend's house or something.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
Now, somebody said to me that Kevin Hart is looking at the film rights to your life. Would you like Kevin Hart to play you?
Now, you know damn well he ain't going to pull it off. Nobody's afraid of Kevin.
No, but I'm saying. No, oh, he's too short.
If you want to be real, either give me John Travolta to play me or Samuel L. Jackson. It's got to be some Pulp Fiction type people in there.
It needs to be a bigger person, not just a bigger name. You need some height, some heft. I got you. How about Denzel?
There we go.
All right. Wow, Kevin Hart, too short and just not just too funny. How about Chris Rock doing a drama? How about Chris Rock, dramatic? No,
he's doing like a dish rag. He's washed up. You know what I mean?
He's washed up. All right.
Yeah.
How about this? He's played black before. How about Robert Downey Jr.? Remember when he did that?
Yeah, now there, George Clooney.
Pineapple, whatever it was. George Clooney, all of it. All right. Right. Now, I don't have a picture of you in front of me. Are you a light-skinned black man or a dark-skinned black man?
Dark.
Oh, so they have to have some heavy makeup. How would you feel about a white man playing you? Would that be kind of unwritten?
Let me tell you something.
What?
Because you mentioned Robert Downey, but if I had it my way, it'd be Mr. Heath Ledger. Since I can't have it that way, it would be my good friend, Mr. Dunn from the Jackasses, that Ryan Dunn that perished. So
you wanted the guy from Jackass to play you in this serious film?
Oh yeah.
Wow.
Ryan Dunn had a set of iron balls, let me tell you, Jay.
Really?
Yes.
Really?
Yeah.
You think he would be a good actor in a film like this? In blackface? Wait a second. Ryan Dunn in blackface.
He's cast now, but he would have been great.
I know. I know. Doggone. Let's go.
George Clooney. Robert Downey can pull it off. He did it in Tropical, whatever it was.
Trap Thunder.
Yeah, Tropic Thunder. That's right.
I didn't know that was Robert until the end of the credits. God damn you.
Wow. let's go to, by the way, are you married or single, Charles? What's your sex life and relationship life like since this excitement?
I have a girlfriend. Her name is Jennifer.
Did you have her before?
Yeah, she keeps me down there.
Does she ever pretend that she's a captive somewhere and you have to go down and rescue her?
She likes to get in there, but then I kind of break her out of that role play and say, honey, that's a touchy subject, like Joan cracking jokes.
Yeah. Well, what you want to do is you pretend you're tied up and then you untie her with your teeth.
You
it takes
go.
A lot longer.
You're right. Yeah. Like, come get me pregnant and beat the baby out of me.
No, let's not. We don't want to do that. We don't want to do that. CharlesRamseyWorld.com, the new book, Dead Giveaway, which, of course, is, you know, his famous saying there from when the woman ran into his arms. It was a dead giveaway that something was wrong. The rescue, the hamburgers, white folks, and instant celebrity. And what you saw on TV doesn't begin to tell the story. What does that mean, that last line?
I got thrust into the limelight, obviously, because you know my name. I became a household name within 72 hours.
What do you mean you had to clean it? You had to clean it.
No,
what does that mean?
He became a household name.
Oh, he became. I thought you said you clean your name up. Have you ever been arrested? No. Were you ever in trouble with the police?
Of course. I got penitentiary stints. What black person?
Oh, wow.
Other than Barack Obama.
What did you go to the penitentiary for?
Domestic violence, drug dealing, aggravated drug dealing.
Wow. So you beat the shit out of a woman. So you know what that's like to slap a woman around.
Yeah, the police got there before I could actually hit her.
Oh, you were winding up and they came in?
Yes. Yeah.
Wow. You take a long time to swing, huh?
No, I like to argue.
I see. Wow.
So you didn't then, really, so having to call the cops is a little unsettling, right? When all of the this was going down, like you have to make a decision. Do I call the cops and bring them all over here, or, you know, do I say?
Well, here's another thing, and somebody just called and said this. Somebody said, did you lose any street cred because you're a snitch?
Yeah, you can't be considered a snitch in this situation. If you let all it right. go, you'll be considered inhuman.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right.
So if you're not from the streets, then I wouldn't even try to guess what the terminology is.
Okay. All right. And so financially, the book's coming out. They've offered you burgers or not or whatever. I mean, can you go get a regular job now? Are you still just going to a business even though you're this big celebrity and this hero?
Oh, I get a job anywhere. Do I want a job anywhere is the question. Of course not.
Oh, you're not interested in the job. Okay. All right. What are you doing for money?
Probably spitting on everything on planet Earth, and I'm looking at shit on Pluto. What do you think?
Wow. You need a loan? I can give you a loan.
Yeah, I talked to Mr. Glenn Beck tomorrow in Dallas, so hopefully he got that covered for me.
Wow. I know Glenn Beck. I sure do. I know him.
Oh, I think have you ever talked to him? Of course you know him.
Yes, I have talked. Yes, I've talked to him.
Yeah. Good. I'm flying out here tomorrow. I'll be in Dallas tomorrow. So hopefully with or without the book, I'll be financially stable.
Is that a two-way ticket or a one-way ticket?
Yeah, Mr. Beck doesn't play. He didn't invite me, so I think this is a freeway. I get to come.
You know what would be funny is if they flew you there, but they only flew you back to, like, Akron.
Right.
That's funny.
I got no problem with that. Give me back in Ohio.
All right. Well, look, man, congratulations, Charles. Enjoy it. The book is out there now, and it's 165 action-packed pages, and I just can't wait till you release the other 235 pages of the fucks, the shit, the pisses, the sons of bitches, the MF, all of it. I can't wait. CharlesRamseyWorld.com, the new book, Dead Giveaway. Kevin, any final words before we say goodbye to Charles?
Good luck. Are you still washing dishes?
For Jennifer.
Okay.
Happy wife, happy life, Charles.
Charles, you were great. Thank you very much, Charles. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Have a good day.
Thanks.
Bye, Charles.
Right. He's fantastic.
I told you, he is a amazing guy.
He's amazing.
Amazing. He is
unbelievable.
Treasure.
Someone on the phone says they're Angel Cordera from Cleveland. That area code. Yes, go ahead. Who are you?
I am Angel Cordero, long-time listener, first-time caller.
All right. We have Mr. Cordero. Yes, you just heard your reputation was pretty much besmirched a few moments ago. What's your rebuttal to Charles Ramsey?
This guy's a lazy son of a bitch.
I see.
I work at Taco Bell, and he used to work there as a dishwasher. He no work. He just pretended to be a hero. I'm a hero.
Has Taco Bell offered you diarrhea for a lifetime?
Absolutely. I want to say yo quiero Taco Bell. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Angel Cordero. Great. Great. The Jay Thomas Show. Wow. I tell you what, I'm just filled with energy now. After that, Christina, do we have any, I don't know if you'll have them or not. Do you have any of the,
I don't have them. No.
The phone calls. I can't think of the name of those phone calls.
Voice box?
But I know we have them on this show. That's a good guess.
Yeah, we do.
All right. Stay where you are. We'll be right back.
The Jay Thomas Show.
Afternoons. Sirius XM 104.
So after the show last night, I was invited out to a Prince house for a crawfish boil. And what's funny is if you go to, many of you have been to a very fancy restaurant, perhaps.
Did they cook them in the stockings?
Yeah, we do all that. Well, yeah, the stuff. But what's funny is that, and I took pictures of it. I'll send you from my phone, Christina, or somebody.
Okay.
And not that I'd forgotten this, but, you know, you go to a restaurant and they serve you a metal platter of a crawfish, right? But it's not a dozen, it's not two dozen or whatever, it's like 4 pounds.
Is this when they put the brown paper on the...
You can't do it that way. You can do that too, yeah. You do it too. But last night...
Out of claws.
They cooked 40 pounds of crawfish, 40. There were nine people. No, delicious, fantastic. Mm-hmm. Nine people. The women and the men, I don't eat like this. Everybody ate over 4 pounds of crawfish. There wasn't any crawfish left. And I only ate like 2 or 3 pounds or whatever. And not even that, probably. Maybe a half a pound. Who knows? And they said, what's the matter with you? I said, well, you know, I don't eat as much as I used to or something like that. It's so crazy how and one of the women made a wall of, you know, discarded heads on her platter and was trying to get it up as high as she could before it fell. And I'm sitting there thinking, man, oh, man, when's the last time you ate over 4 pounds of food, Kevin, at a sitting, just 4 pounds?
Oh, God. That's
a lot of food.
I couldn't do that.
It's weird. I guess I could years ago. My brother ate his 4 pounds and almost all of mine.
Oh, what happened to the brother?
My brother? Oh, he never went to Baton Rouge.
Never went?
No.
So what happened to the, did you talk to him about the title again? Or
I said to him this morning, okay, now look, this is not true, but I'm going to say it. June 1st, they're canceling the insurance on the boat. So if we wreck the boat or something happens or gets stolen, we won't get any of our money back.
Your $80,000 that it's worth.
You won't get any money back. The 50, 40, whatever we have in it.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to the library right now. What are you going to the library for? Because I'm going to go online and try and, you know, do it electronically. I go, what about your computer at home? Oh, well, I was stealing a signal from someone and they caught me. That's just how he said it. I was stealing a signal from someone and they caught me.
How can they catch you stealing a signal?
I think he probably told someone he was using such and such a whatever, and their computer was running slowly or whatever, and they said, well, that's mine. They put a lock on it.
Yeah.
You know.
Oh,
yeah.
That is so,
so he's at a library at a computer right now trying to do it. Now, remember, I told him we will. And I guarantee you that when we go get the boat on Sunday, he won't even mention we have no insurance.
Mm-hmm.
You know, during Katrina, we found our other boat in a tree. And the boat was worth maybe $10,000 or $15,000. And the insurance is $225 a year, right?
Mm-hmm.
I go down to collect on our boat. He never paid the insurance thing ever. That's it.
Well, you knew that. You knew he would never pay.
You know what? I when I got there, I knew it, and then I thought, what an I'll never that. It's odd to me. Mm-hmm. I just can't imagine that. Okay, so you don't have the money, so ask me for the money, whatever it is. I don't know. He just became a boat captain. He's going to take people out into the ocean fishing. I got to tell you, I can't wait. I mean, we're going to be reading about him.
I think he's going to lead people places.
No, you're going to see news with helicopters and capsized, and everyone will be dead except my brother. And they'll be pulling him up, you know, and he'll be like Charles Ramsey. He'll write a book. I did everything I could. I swam. I dove 9 times, you know. You know,
I've got to meet this guy.
Oh, he's a great guy.
I've got to come there to New Orleans.
Great. Oh, I'm here all month. You're welcome. Anytime. All right.
Okay.
Christina, you're welcome. Come on down.
Thanks. I'm going to run your board if we're all down there.
Well, Gary will run it. You'll come in here and you'll do something.
Okay.
Greg says, Jay, since you're in,
she could do it.
Since you're in New Orleans, is your Uncle Wade in New Orleans? No, Uncle Wade's dead. And he married my Aunt Chris. And Uncle Wade had some sort of either a speech impediment or some sort of a Cajun thing that we couldn't get.
Mm.
But my aunt, who was really intelligent and was married to an English professor who drank a quart of vodka and shot himself twice on Father's Day and died. And she flunked the lie detector test twice, and they found my cousin Mark hiding under the house after he'd been let go for the weekend from the insane asylum. So she marries Wade, and Wade called me right there. I tell him, John, I've seen your aunt about 41 years, and we went out 41 years ago, and I fucked her, too. That's how he thought. Mm-hmm. He told me he fucked my aunt 41 years before they remarried.
Oh, God.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. He thought. Now, he kept every receipt, Kevin, of groceries and everything they spent during their marriage. And they get a divorce. Mm-hmm. And he takes all of these receipts to court.
Yeah.
And because of those receipts, she got no settlement and no alimony. I never heard of anything like that. You know, you're laughing.
You always save your receipts. They always no, say, but, you save know, your receipts.
I've asked lawyers. If a lawyer is listening,
yes.
What would the court have heard? And I mean everything they ever bought.
He spent a lot of money on her. That's
yes.
Why.
Well, we all do.
Yeah, and but he if has you, the receipts.
But if you save your receipts and go, this is what she spent, do they charge that back off against your ex? I didn't know that.
She didn't save her receipts.
No, she didn't. Well, She didn't save her receipts.
He did, and he won.
Right.
Always have to have good paperwork. You know, it really is very important to
keep good records. Did we have earlier? We had Cool Barista. It's time for Cool Dad.
Ooh, a cool dad
yeah.
coming up.
We had a cool that. Dad. Oh, yeah.
Dang.
Yeah.
Cool,
and you might actually be able to find some audio or video. Yeah.
Cool dad.
Yeah, baby. Cool dad. Let's go down to Douglasville. No, Douglasville, Georgia. Police have arrested a Douglasville dad on child cruelty charges. But after you hear this, you may not think it's so cruel. He punished his 16-year-old son, Charlie Mays did, by making him carry a 23-pound landscape stone for several miles.
Wow.
He's been charged with first-degree child cruelty.
That's a cool dad.
He said his son had watched too many videos, did not do any chores, and was flunking in school. So over a three-day period, he started him at 3 in the morning, and he made the child carry a 23-pound garden stone from, I guess, where they had bought it to the house before the dad put them in the yard. Wow.
Okay.
He was made to move rocks and stuff from one side of the backyard to another. Now, you know what? Do you think that's an arrestable offense? Do you?
Yeah, it's child abuse.
You know, it's...
I don't think so.
23 pounds?
I don't think it's child abuse, but...
I don't
these
either.
Kids today, they know. They know if you do something stupid, they can call the cops.
When I was a kid, I used to say, I'm going to call the cops on you. Now the kids are like, I'm going to call Child Protective Services on you.
Yeah.
And my mom used to be like, here, let me dial for you. And then she'd dial 911 and then say in the phone, go ahead, tell them what a terrible mother I am. And then I got scared and I would hang up.
Well,
and they would never show up at my door and suspect that there's foul play. They're just like, oh, another stupid kid.
Oh, right. She didn't dial 911.
I promise you, Kevin.
I know, but she did something with her finger.
I don't know what she did.
Yeah,
she dialed
the mothers are smart.
And she said, here, tell them what a terrible mother I am to you.
She's so smart, your mother. Your mother's so smart.
Hey, Kevin, probably really hard to fake out young Christina.
Oh.
You know what I'm saying? Let's hear the report from Douglasville, Georgia, where I don't find this to be. Here we go.
Child by putting him in a cage.
Abusing a young
father is now accused of cruelty to his teenage son. By sending him on a forced march that began here at King's Highway and Highway 5.
He is approximately 4'2" tall and about 144 pounds.
According to Douglasville police, 40-year-old Charlie Mays also made his small 16-year-old son carry one of these, a large landscaping paving stone the entire time, a stone that weighed nearly 23 pounds.
Ooh,
they even made him carry it 3 miles to their home several times over the weekend, day and night.
In between that time, he was at home having to move rocks and stuff from one side of the backyard to the other, and then being taken right back out to the same location, dropped off, and made to walk back again.
A military veteran with no criminal record, Mays told police he was using military-style discipline to punish his son for watching too many videos and not doing his schoolwork.
he did right. not feel that this was inappropriate at all, and neither did his wife.
A woman at the couple's home told us they had no comment. Meanwhile, Charlie Mays faces one count of child
cruelty. Who is beaten regularly.
Got out of the Douglas County Jail on $3,500 bond Memorial Day.
Wow. Paul
Crawley, 11 Live News.
Ah, that was a great report.
I mean, if they refused to give him water or let him, you know, is any of that in the report? Like, was he refused anything? Or
No. They made him do a heavy lifting, and they made him carry.
How big was he? Is he 4 foot 11 and he's...
No, 4 foot two.
4 foot two and he's 140 pounds?
Is that what they said?
That's was it four? Fat.
Right,
we don't need to add.
No, wait a minute.
He must be 4 foot 11.
If he's
he
four
was skinny.
Foot two and 140 pounds.
Oh yeah, that's heavy. Yeah.
That's heavy.
Yeah.
That's fat and that's roly poly.
But you know, you just say it with this. He's fat.
I can say that now. I can say that. Okay.
Well, how did he carry that stone? He must be pretty strong. You know.
Well, that's what makes it abuse. Is that he's not in any condition to be doing something like that.
All right. The dad didn't hit him, didn't do anything to him.
Didn't whip him when he was...
No.
That's next. Yeah.
No. Well, the $3,500 bond is going to get the dad mighty pissed.
Yeah.
The Italians are... And this is, you know, here they are, you know, the Italians who certainly have had some gaudy, garish things in their time. When Kim Kardashian and Kanye got married there, they found that... They picked a spot where the only way that anything, tables, anything could get to where they wanted to get married was to be lifted, I want to say, a couple of hundred feet, 230 feet in the air.
230 feet.
Yes, to the top of a grassy ridge at the Forte di Belvedere.
Mm-hmm.
And when they brought up the porta potties... They were painted gold for some reason.
They were
and
gold.
They became the largest item that you could see. And they're now calling it, I'm going to find it here in Italian, Torre di Bagni Oro. Torre di Bagni Oro. Let's go around the horn. You can bring Caroline in here. You may or may not speak Italian. The toilets, the golden toilets, were brought up to the top of the hill, and the Italians started laughing at them. And you know, and by the way, when people were asked why they were famous, no one could answer that question.
Yeah.
No one. Not even Kanye West, no. Torre di Bagni Oro. Caroline, what do you think that means in Italian? It's a put-down of porta-potties. What do you think it is?
What it means? I don't know. Someone who abuses animals.
Hold on a minute. Would you speak into a microphone first of all, right into it?
I don't know.
Someone that abuses animals. Oh my God.
Someone you know who abuses animals.
Yeah.
I heard her. Get back to the phones. Good God, Christina. What is it? Torre di Bagni Oro.
Toilet of gold.
No. Toilet of gold. That's close. That's close.
Kevin
Torre di Bagni Oro.
Shitter in the sky.
Shitter in the sky. It means the golden toilet tower.
Okay. Very nice.
We should call it the golden toilet shower.
They called the entire wedding ceremony.
Weird in it.
Yeah, that's weird.
They used other Italian terms that Kanye and Kim Kardashian, since they don't speak Italian, actually thought it was a compliment when the Italian newspapers in Italian said that the wedding of Kanye West and Kim Kardashian was overshadowed by the Torre di Bagni Oro, and Kanye West and Kim Kardashian both thought that was the fountain that had the champagne in it or something. All right?
And it was the toilet.
It was the toilets. They had no idea. Instead of place cards,
they
had marble tabletop was brought up. Each person's name that was invited, their name was
carved.
Carved.
In stone.
Engraved.
By an engraver that they hired just to carve their names in this stone for their place
Jay.
Their names.
The wedding planners had spelled so many people's names incorrectly that the only two people that sat in their own correct seats were Kim and Kanye.
And how many people were at the wedding?
300 or 400.
Four days before the wedding, they ordered 30 life-size nudes to be made from black marble. The marble workers worked through the night to cut enough blocks, but 10 of them fell apart, and another 10 were too damaged in transit to put out.
Oh,
out of the remaining 10, four were missing their heads. They were put out around the dinner table.
The heads were?
Mm-hmm.
You know, here, the weird thing about them is, and you know, you can buy a good lawyer, right? And you can also buy celebrity. I know Kanye West is considered, you know, an entertainer and a singer and everybody, yeah, rap, whatever the fuck he is. But literally,
according to him,
she is completely talentless unless it's selling, you know, big-ass, extra-large clothing to women at Target. I mean, if you consider that a
Sears
talent,
Sears,
well, whatever it is. Kanye came to the venue 2 hours before the wedding.
This is what I find really fascinating, that he comes to the venue.
2 hours.
Well, he planned this whole thing. She had nothing to do with
but
it.
But he starts going, he goes in there, and tell us what the report says here, Jay. It's
well, he ordered the marble nudes moved further away from the dance floor.
And how declaring, much did they weigh?
A lot. They took four or five
half
people
a ton
each. Yeah.
They weighed half a ton.
Yeah, 1,000 pounds. I'm the center of this party. He declares this.
Yes.
And I'm the only one people need to see. Mm-hmm. He didn't want these
This was about the lighting?
To be fair, this is Kim's third wedding. So, I mean, to say that it's about the bride at this point, it shouldn't be. It should be about the groom. This should be.
Kanye got on the microphone as they were setting up and said, I want all of the lights trained on me. The rest of these people don't need lights on them.
Yes.
The lights had taken 4 days to install, and he had ordered them to be removed, and a crane had to take them back down the 230 feet. Then he returned an hour before the wedding.
Before the
wedding. Yeah.
Yes.
Then when he came back later...
Does this sound like an insane man?
Yeah, he's nuts.
Yeah. Have you ever seen an interview with him?
Yeah, yes.
He's just reprimanding you the whole time. Mm-hmm. I'm the best. You're going to love me. I'm the best.
He didn't like the all-white bar that was in front of the golden toilet tower.
Okay, so what did he do?
He took a saw and started sawing it in half. 2 men held the bar stable as Kanye sawed. And a guy there that spoke Italian, Italian and English, said if he would have known what the Italians were saying about him and to him, he would have been very angry. They were not being kind in a lot of different languages.
Well, they're very passionate. Italians.
They sawed and they sawed and they sawed into the bar, never able to saw it in half, but defacing the entire front of it with everyone screaming at him to stop.
Why did they saw the bar in half?
He said it looked like a bar from Texas.
Yeah. Now, what about
he said it looked bad.
Now, they had, there's something about the sound system that they had.
No. Yeah, he ordered 2 pieces of raw, unpainted wood to be nailed onto the front of the bar, so it wouldn't look like a bar from Texas.
Here, as far as the sound system goes,
yes.
He saw that there was a $136,000 audio system.
$136,000 audio system.
But Sir Kanye did not like the look of the speakers and wanted them to be invisible.
Uh-huh.
He said that you Italians don't understand my minimalist style, so he had the entire system pulled out as the guests were arriving, and his wedding music came from an iPod until after dinner.
So they spend $136,000 on a sound system, and then he takes it down because he doesn't like the way
he's a minimalist.
Yes.
He likes, he's a minimalist.
Wow. Will Smith's son, Jaden.
Oh, this is the greatest.
He wore a Batman costume and ran around like a chicken with his head cut off.
It was a white
and
Batman
for 3 hours, he knocked glasses off of tables, and he came to an empty seat. He'd smashed them on the ground. And Vogue Italy's editor, Franca Sociani, was getting irritated. He would come up behind her and throw his cape over her head. All right, we're going to go around the horn one more time. As the Italians all stood, and they had been sawing on this bar,
yes.
Kanye has these two pieces of unremarkable plywood nailed into the front of the white bar. He turned to the Italians, and he said, okay, now, that's what? Christina?
Now that's art.
Now that's art. Kevin, now
that's the way we roll.
No. Christina wins. Now that's art. Yeah.
He's very artistic, that Kanye West. Everything
and,
is art
and
to him.
By the way, the Italian construction workers looked at him and could not believe what they were seeing.
Yeah.
Okay. They arrived finally in a carriage, you know, like a king and queen carriage.
Yeah.
I mean, it's pretty. Now, here's what's weird, Christina. Do you really think for 1 minute, I mean, Kim Kardashian has kind of been taken over by her mother and her fake celebrity or whatever.
Well, now she's taken over by Kanye West.
Do you think there's any love or any passion between them?
I think that it's a really, really good, secure business deal.
And well, they have the baby, too. They have the, what's the baby's name?
It's
Northwest.
Yeah.
Northwest, right.
I think that she probably really loves the idea of him.
Northwest.
And he's, you know, there's been claims that he's been in love with her forever.
Is he gay at all?
No, and all
he's
of these,
gay.
Well, who knows. But
I'm
all
naming
of these
my next he's child, gotten, he's like, I'm naming Tropic of Cancer. That's what I'm naming my next child.
Really?
No more, not, no, how about this one? Wait a minute. You ready for this one? Hold on.
I don't know.
I'm naming my next child the Equator.
There you go. That went over really well.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
You're welcome. No, but I think that this just secures her celebrity. And, you know, who cares? It's not even real. Who cares? You know what I mean? Life is not real. Life is just what you
make. Life is not real with them, no.
That's what I'm saying. In their head, it's like they just create everything around them.
They're creators,
and then it happens.
Yeah.
So.
In a few moments, if you catch your wife texting, how large of a garden stone will you make her carry up a hill? If you catch your wife...
Chexting.
I can't wait to
Chexting.
Find out
what
that means. Ooh. Chexting. It's breaking up happy homes all across America.
Yeah.
It'll be our relationship report on the Jay Thomas Show with Kevin Meaney and Christina Palumbo. Garrett Andritz is no longer with us.
The Afternoon Drive Show. Jay Thomas. Indy. SiriusXM 104. And on the SiriusXM app for smartphones.
I love this song.
Wow.
An oldie but a goodie.
Yeah.
Yeah. Solid gold to make you feel old.
Yeah.
So last night I was at my crawfish boil. And about 10 o'clock, and my buddy, Bubby Valentino, who went to high school with
us. Bubby on this
Bubby
show.
Valentino,
And he likes to go out at night, and he likes to stay out, you know, likes to stay out late and stuff. And so he calls me at, like, you know, 10 o'clock. He says, I'm going over to the Maple Leaf, which is this great bar and music everywhere, right? And so I meet him over there, you know. And there's no one there. There's like two people. And I go, Jesus, you know, it's 10 o'clock. You know, who are we? He said, these are a bunch of musicians that just got together tonight. And, you know, they've maybe rehearsed one time or whatever. And I go, oh. The next thing you know, this guy named Eric Bloom is just blowing, you know, this trumpet and absolutely knocking us dead. And by midnight, the place was packed. It's a Wednesday night, right? The place is packed. So I'm standing there going, Jesus, you know, I just had like 4 pounds of crawfish. And now I'm hearing, unbelievable music, unreal. And it's just some guys that got together. They were killing it. So I walk outside and there's three college types, travelers with the backpacks. A good-looking girl and two skinny white guys. And it's $10 to get in. and the band is on break, but I'm leaving. So I turn to them and I say, where are y'all from? And they go, one's Minnesota, one, Illinois, whatever. I go, now remember, it's at midnight in New Orleans, and they're with their backpacks, and they're wondering whether they should go into this bar or not, where the most expensive drink is like $4. I say, the band's unbelievable. It's a bunch of guys who got together. You won't believe this trumpet player. Do you know the more I said how great the band was, the less they wanted to go into the club? And finally I said to them, you know, the more I'm telling you how great it is inside, I see you like trying to leave. What's the matter with you three? And I said, if you walk with these backpacks down one of these streets, tomorrow morning they're going to find your bodies in body bags next to empty backpacks. Has anybody told you about this town? And they just stared at me, and I said, get your $10 out, go in, watch this guy till 2 a.m, and then get a cab back to the bedbug-infested hostel, and do not walk back with your friggin' backpack. That was my evening. Crawfish, incredible jazz, and then advice. What do you think of that? That's a full night, isn't it?
Yeah.
I'm going to go somewhere tonight and give advice. I'm going to go to One Eye Jack's. It's like a theater club where you go dancing and stuff. I'm going to give advice when I go in there.
Where's a place where I can do comedy down there, do a show?
Oh, my God. They have all sorts of places.
No, I was looking online. I really can't find any. You know, I know they have them in the casinos.
Harris used to do it. Harris doesn't do it anymore.
But that's like, you know, it'd be the improv. I need a club. I need like a place where a venue where I can go down and for wallet.
Oh, well, the Joy Theater.
The Joy Theater?
The Joy Theater. Yeah, that's where Bubby wanted to. He wanted to do Vegas, but yeah, he also wants to do it seats 700.
Oh, that's too much.
It's a lot. Yeah, I know. It's a lot of. You'd have to bring others with you.
I want to do like a 200-seat theater. You and me.
We could probably four-wall at Harris.
You think so?
Yeah, I think they have a small room. Yeah.
Yeah. While you're down there, let's look into it.
Okay.
See if we can do
good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening.
You're the greatest. You're the greatest host.
Good evening,
ladies and gentlemen. We'll give you different things to do. We'll do a man on the street thing. We can do it out there with a little camera.
Yeah.
During the day.
Show everything.
Yeah, it'd be great.
Sure. All right. Let's go to Jackie, who is in Cape Cod. Yes, Jackie. Boy, that's lovely there this time of year, isn't it? Cape Cod. Too bad John F. Kennedy couldn't seem to find the airport. Other than that, what a lovely place.
Yeah, I know it is tricky to find the airport there, you know, the one and only actual airport. But
he didn't know whether the ocean was below him or the sky was above him or the ocean was. You know that? He didn't know whether he was right side up or upside down. I'm not joking. He was.
Well, it's a tricky place out here, you know.
Well, it was.
The water and drive 2 miles, hit more water. It's really difficult. Yeah. So
it was very
foggy.
He shouldn't
have been flying.
Very foggy, and he wasn't.
Every
trained.
Day, it's foggy. It's exactly right. Veteran pilots did not take off that night. He also has a broken foot, consequently, a wife that he couldn't stand, and a sister-in-law that he hated. He killed himself and these two individuals.
And he had a bunch of coke on him.
No, he didn't.
Oh, boy.
It's a rumor. Well, Jackie, it's a pleasure to have you there. And what are you doing in Cape Cod? I mean, are you like a tourism person?
Well, no. Well, kind of. Growing up, you work in a restaurant, work the summer months, and then in the winter, you try and find another job. So.
And what do you do now? What do you do
I'm
now?
I'm a hearing instrument specialist.
Really?
So.
Say that again.
Yeah.
Are you
he
the one?
He work in a restaurant, too. What?
There are two tests that I've always wondered about.
Uh-huh.
The eye test, where the lights... Maybe they come on, Kevin, maybe they don't, and you're supposed to press a button when you think you see a light,
right?
And the light will move all around you. And the other one is the hearing test, where in your headphones, you've got the headphones on, you've got that little clicker in your hand, and you hear,
beep. Beep.
Or maybe you don't. Or maybe you
hear, yeah, you do that.
Yeah.
Yes.
After a while, you don't know whether you're hearing anything or not, and you press the button anyway, you know?
Right. Yeah, you get button happy, and you're hearing, like, fake beeps and stuff.
Oh,
like
they
that.
Have a name
so,
for it.
Button so what happy. Do you do? What do you? How do you weed out our buddy, our button happiness? I don't get it. How do you do it?
Well, I know if I'm presenting a tone or not, so, you know, I know if you actually heard something or not.
Oh, at that moment. I got you.
Yeah, I mean, you do it manually. You make, you know, I make a sound, and you tell me if you heard it. It's really that simple. I mean, it's really that easy.
Right.
But,
all right.
Yeah, so.
So now you live in Cape Cod. What did you call about, by the way, Jackie?
Well, I was calling because I found that little the cool dad story kind of interesting, because that's the same kind of stuff my dad used to do to me. And I think it's amazing. I think everybody should do to that to their punk kids. So,
what did your dad? What did he make? What did your dad make you do?
Well, he's a mason contractor, and I was I grew up in Cape Cod, so we just hung out in the woods and smoked pot when we were teenagers. And so to reprimand me, my dad would take me out of school, and I'm only like 85 pounds and 5'2", so, and I'm still that size. So he used to take me out, and he'd put me up on the roof out in Truro on a sand dune on a big house and make me mix concrete and lay brick. And I froze my ass off, and I learned my lesson, that's for sure. So I think it's a great punishment.
What I don't get is, I think if I said to either one of my sons, okay, pick up that stone or turn on that concrete mixer, they would say, no, I'm not going to do it. And unless I beat them, they wouldn't do it. And I think if I had a daughter, it would be even harder. What I don't get is why did you do it? Why didn't you go, no, I'm not going to do it?
Because he's scary. That's what parents are for. They're supposed to put the fear in you. So
you were afraid he was going to hit you. Did you think he was going to hit you?
And he never did either, but he's a big dude, and he scared the crap out of me. So
you
do what he says, or you're, in big trouble. That's how it used to be,
Suppose Peter Dinklage was your dad.
You grew up in the 80s, didn't you, Jackie?
Yeah, but,
yes,
Jackie,
I did.
Suppose Peter Dinklage was your dad. And this little dwarf, and you were a regular size.
You
person.
Are a horrible human being.
This is the third time he's mentioned
you. Really,
I really
are a horrible human being.
No.
I think a little ding every time you mention him, just so that we can
imagine Peter Dinklage is your father, and this little dwarf.
Yeah.
Okay. So
I mean, that is a horrible,
dwarf.
horrible.
No, if your dad was not just a dwarf, like Peter Dinklage, who's very intelligent and can be very scary, but probably physically you could have handled him. What do you think you would have done?
What I would have done?
Yes.
I don't know. I was probably high at the time.
No, you would still respect him because it doesn't matter. Back in the 80s, you were afraid to disappoint your parents, and you were afraid of your parents. Now, their kids are, everybody's afraid of their kids, and all the kids have allergies, every single one.
Yeah, right. And my dad's an Italian guy from New Jersey, too, so he's got that tough guy thing, and you got to listen. That's how it is.
So kind of a Tony Soprano kind of a thing.
I bet you if my dad
I wouldn't tell him that. He might take that to his head. But
yeah.
Speaking of New Jersey Italian guys, I saw Steve Sciarippa yesterday on the subway on the way here to the show, Jay.
What a nice guy.
He is.
He's a very nice guy. Yeah, he's been on the show.
I said I was going to do your show, and he goes, oh, yeah, I've...
Very nice guy.
I know Jay. He's a good guy. He goes, a lot of people don't want to do his show.
No, they didn't. No, he didn't say that.
Yes, he did say that.
Why would he say that?
Because sometimes you get a little crazy.
Oh, stop it.
Don't shoot the messenger, okay? This is what he had said to me.
You know what? I'm going to tell you. I don't believe that, and I think that's just some sort of, I believe you saw him, but I don't think he said that.
Yes, he did.
Look how nice I'm being to Jackie of Cape Cod. I'm being polite. I just had Charles Ramsey on.
Yeah, but before you had him on, you're like, Christina, he's a homeless drug dealer. And I'm like, no, he's not, Jay.
Excuse me.
Exactly. See, this is, but Steve, and I said, this is so true, Steve, but I said the reason why is because Jay tells it like it is, okay? He's a straight shooter, and I said, you can deal with it, Steve. And he goes, I know. He goes, I have no problem with anything like that. You know, I just go with the flow.
Christina, please rebook Steve Sciarippa, please.
Okay.
All right, thank you. Jackie of Cape Cod, and you've grown up to, now how do you punish your children?
Well, I don't have children.
God bless you.
So So,
were your ovaries injured by the concrete mixing machine?
Well, I don't know. And I haven't gotten pregnant yet, so they could have been.
Good girl.
You know, yep.
I'm 31, yep. And you know, I haven't gotten knocked up. So either I'm really smart or.
Or you're barren and you don't know it.
Now, I've been married. Wait a second. She's not barren.
I could have ran out of eggs by now. Who knows?
Oh. That's what I'm hoping happens to me. I just want to dry up so I don't
have to take this fucking pill. Let me tell you how, if you want to get pregnant, I'm going to tell you exactly how to get pregnant, okay?
Oh, I know how. I've just avoided it this far, you know?
You've dodged the bullet. You keep dodging the bullet.
Yes.
But if you want an instantaneous child, whenever you decide you want a child, I have an instantaneous way for you to get the child.
Okay, how's that?
It never fails.
Yeah, but what if you run out of eggs?
No. You go to a girlfriend's bachelorette party. And you drink as much as you can drink, and you smoke dope, and you get as loaded as you can get. Okay. And then after the black stripper that she's hired finishes his job, after he fucks you, you'll be pregnant.
Yeah,
it never fails. Now, remember, it must be a black stripper. And for some reason, white women's eggs are attracted to the black strippers at these bachelorette parties. And it always happens.
Especially on Cape Cod. I didn't go that route, but boy, let me tell you, a lot of the girls I grew up with, they've gone that route.
Oh, well, no, it works.
So,
it works. It works.
Yeah, you don't even need a stripper. You just have to go to the local fishing pool and open your life.
But Christina and Kevin, have you not heard? Hey, what happened? Oh, did you not hear? She went to the bachelorette party. The black stripper guy.
I've never heard that.
Never in my life.
Oh, yes, you have.
In my life.
Oh, yes, you have.
Thank you, Christina.
And now she's having the baby. She doesn't know whether to have an abortion or the black stripper's child. She doesn't know what.
You're still reading Penthouse Farm or something. You know, it's like, you know. That's where you're getting these ideas from.
I'm telling you. Oh, all right.
That's not a bad idea.
Jackie.
Yes, it's a terrible idea. Don't
worry. Jackie, since my wife would get really upset, I could probably impregnate you, but I think your child would be born with gray hair. That's the problem with my sperm. Other than that,
anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, Jackie, you're 31.
You're
31. I'm old enough to be your dad, but if we met in a bar and you found me, you know, pleasant, and would you even consider sleeping with me?
I don't know.
Keep in mind, it's not going to get you anywhere in your career.
No. You know what, Christina? People aren't thinking like that. This is a very nice person from Cape Cod. She would do it to perhaps have some fun, Christina.
She might want to be on the radio in Cape Cod.
You should think about next time you have sex. Why don't you know, instead of like, who are you going to screw to get to the top? I'm sorry, Jackie. What are you saying? What are you saying? Go ahead.
I am dating a music teacher, so I guess I could really. I guess some would say.
Well, if you're dating a music teacher, you may want to fuck Kevin. You may want Kevin and not me.
Oh, boy.
Okay? Yeah.
Oh, why? Because music teachers are gay?
No, they have very dainty hands, though.
Yes, he does have dainty hands because he's playing a guitar all day.
Now, let me ask a question. Have I said one thing that didn't come true about the black stripper at the bachelorette party and now the dainty-handed music teacher? Am I not almost 100% correct in my generalizations? All right?
You are delusional. That's what you are.
Almost there, Jay, and good for you.
You really are delusional. Almost.
Jackie, do you listen to this show? Jackie.
I mean, I don't know. It depends.
Well, I have those.
I don't know.
Now, Jackie, I shave.
I don't want to be insulting.
I shave. I shave down there completely so that if a young girl ever wants me,
that's not good either. It's like sandpaper.
It's like you use the no-no down there. That's what you use.
Like a really old baby.
I used to pluck my gray pubic hairs, but they got to be so plentiful, I started just shaving.
You plucked it?
You didn't have any tears when you plucked them?
No, I did not. You know what I got, though? I got these pimples. I got these pimples, so I just stopped plucking.
Oh, jeez. squeezing, plucking.
You know what's funny? After I had so many pimples my wife said to me, "Did you come?" I said, "No, I didn't." She said, "Well, what is all of this here?" Apparently, she had been popping my pimples and it was pus. It was pus.
Yeah. All right, I'm leaving. Goodbye. Goodbye.
Oh my God.
I'm out of here.
You sound
I'm
like
gone.
My dad.
I'm gone.
Seriously.
Yeah. There was and I didn't want to use my spooge towel on pus.
Oh God.
All right.
Oh God.
You know what, Jackie? You've opened so many doors for me. I just thank you so much.
You've opened sores, not doors. Sores.
Yeah. Wait a second. Let's keep Jackie on the phone. We have a question from Jason of Chicago for Jackie of Cape Cod. Jason, welcome to the show. What is your question?
My question is, Jackie, are you there?
Yes.
My question is, I'm curious, like Jay is, about the hearing test. When your patients get button happy, and if they push that button and there's not a tone presented, is there a negative consequence on their score? I've always wondered that. How do you deal with that?
Well, no, because I'm inputting it manually, so it's not a machine that's saying yes or no, the person heard that, it's me. So I know if I presented the tone and I know if they really heard it, so I'm recording it manually.
Okay, so if I push the button and you did not present the tone, is that like a demerit or a negative?
No, you know what's really weird? You know what's weird about this? Jackie, stop it. Jason is jerking off right now. He's a sick. Get rid of him. Get rid of this guy. That's such a bullshit question.
Oh my God.
He's one of those guys that'll ask you anything about your business, and he's masturbating while he's doing it.
He can fantasize about getting a hearing test and a blowjob, I guess.
Jackie, God. I had to save you.
Yeah,
I had
and
to.
And then he's Thank popping you. His pin- pimples around his crotch.
So watch
area
this.
Too.
I know.
This is how good he is. I'm jerking off right now, but I'm going to ask you the question. Watch this. Look. So, Jackie, when the hearing, when we hear the little bubble, the little sound, do you listen to the sound yourself, or is there other people that listen to it?
No, I'm listening.
And you're
to
jacking
it over
off right now,
headset.
Jay?
But that's it.
Really?
Kevin Meany, you're out of control. Really?
And so when you finally get the results of the hearing, do you tell them they're deaf right there, or do you wait, Jackie?
No, I can tell them right then.
Good. Thank God. That's when you tell them. Oh, God, you tell them later. That's good.
Oh, I'm dead.
Wow.
Yeah.
Jack. Oh, God, yeah. Jackie.
Get right
thank
to
you.
It.
Jackie.
Yeah. Oh,
God. Thank you very much for
thank
answering
you,
my questions. I appreciate it. See you later.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. So long.
Oh, God.
Are you a little tired now, JJ?
Yeah, we'll be right back. We'll be right back. Yeah.
The Jay Thomas Show. For idiots, by idiots. Stop idiot action. The Jay Thomas Show. He's the afternoon guy. On Indy. Sirius XM 104. And on the Sirius XM app for smartphones. Indy.
Sorry, Shawty Murphy. I was having too much fun.
Wow.
Well, sometimes.
So I mentioned earlier that we would discuss sexting.
Yes, what is this? Sexting.
Well, let's go around the horn. Let's get... Sexting. Is Caroline the telephone answering?
Caroline's in the city. Yep.
All right, Caroline. Speak directly into the microphone, and I just want to say that I've asked you two or three questions, and you may be a little worse than Christina was in the beginning.
She was on fire yesterday.
A little bit. Sexting is when people text?
I think it's sexting with your cell phone in one hand while eating Chex Mix with the other.
Nice.
You're eating, and that's a very good answer.
You're
eating that Chex cereal
with
the other hand. And you're texting and you're sexting at the same time. And it's causing people big problems. That's a great answer. Christina, what do you think of that?
I was going to say the same except with Cheez-Its. That's how I
would be Cheez-Its ticking. Chesexting. That'd be Chesexting.
That would be Chesexting.
That'd be, no, that'd be Chesexting. 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 Chesexting.
They're so good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Hello, Mr. Chesexting. How are you? Kevin, what do you think it is?
I would say it's signing your check with your semen.
Good answer, Kevin.
That's correct.
No, it's not.
It is. It's when.
Because he gets so silent. He gets silent because he gets mad.
No. These people have made their semen into some sort of a dark liquid and put it into inkwells.
Yeah.
And they're using it to sign their.
Is
their
it
checks.
Invisible? You can only see it through light?
No, no. It's it, and but the person that looks at it doesn't know. That
You're
it's so your semen.
Full of shit.
Yes, I am.
Tell him.
Oh, okay.
What it is it's cheat texting, but the cheating is a weird thing. You are texting intimate and emotional things
which
to someone.
Is sexting.
Well, no. You're not sending any. Pictures or anything. You
it
are sending.
It doesn't have to be pictures when you're sexting. It can just be, you know, talking dirty and that kind of
oh,
stuff.
Oh, that's not true. Sexting is penis vagina.
Well, but, yeah. But you're talking about putting the penis in the vagina.
Sexting
or the penis
is
in
penis
the butt,
vagina.
Whatever.
That's what it is.
All right, hold on a minute. One woman says.
Thank you, Your Honor.
My husband left his Facebook up one day and I looked at it. And he had a whole nother life, an emotional life
Charles
with
Carole.
A woman. Wait a minute. With a woman on the Internet. Mm-hmm. She said her man wasn't having sex with another woman, but was sharing his deepest feelings with her.
Mm-hmm.
And they say that this is the latest frontier of betrayal and that it's starting to really break marriages up and relationships because it's emotional sex.
Mm-hmm.
Because your chatting becomes cheating. Wow. Wow. You know, I guess I wouldn't like, you know, to be honest.
You wouldn't like it.
I've actually, you know, I'm pretty sure my wife is seeing someone else. Has been for years. I am. I am positive.
I mean, I can't blame her, but I don't.
No. You know what's odd? I mean, many years ago, she turned completely off to me, and I felt it. But I've quoted the Bible many times that at least 7 times a year, she must have sex with me. It's in the scriptures. And so that's what we do. Pretty medicinal. Mm-hmm. But. I've followed her. I have tried to find things on, you know,
you
her
have.
Phone.
I bet you have followed her.
I have.
Yeah.
And here's the weird thing. If I do find out, I've already planned
to
do anything. No, I plan not to do anything.
Oh, okay.
I just like having the knowledge.
Okay.
Mm.
Because, look.
You're so calculating.
Life is meaningless anyway, so why get all upset if she's treating me nicely? She's treating me nicely, so she's with somebody else.
It really is. Know. Life really is meaningless.
It's by the
there's,
way.
There's really, why do we have to even finish up the day?
Should we just pack it up, Kevin?
I woke up.
I'm throwing the chair out one of those windows.
No, after last night. No, after last night, I had a great meal, I went drinking, I listened to this great band, and I got home, and I said out loud in my really nice home there in New Orleans, I said, now remember this
with
tomorrow.
Termites.
Remember, wait, that's right, remember this tomorrow. You know, expand this into a good day tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
I wake up, 8 o'clock or whatever I wake up, and my first thoughts are wholly negative. Wholly negative.
What were your first thoughts? What were your first thoughts?
That the house is being ruined by the termites, that I can't figure it out financially.
But the drinking, when you were drinking, you were feeling very good. Right?
And I didn't drink that much.
Okay,
and
but
I didn't smoke that much.
I didn't say that. I didn't say
the music, the event, the fun of that evening, the dancing. I said, remember
my
that.
My point
That's,
is you should be listening to more music. You should be having a drink in the afternoon.
I'm doing it all.
You know, and, you know, enjoy yourself. Enjoy life.
In many ways, counselors believe that sexting can be more insidious. A more insidious form of infidelity. I have to tell you something. Once they start all this, there's somebody going to be who knows something about their husband or their wife, and they're going to get mad at this report. I don't. Is it really?
Yeah. When my awful. Wife found out, when she looked at my computer and it said "men seeking men," that wasn't good, you know.
Mm-hmm. No.
No.
And I said, listen, I was looking to get together a flag football team.
Now, here's what's funny. I didn't open.
I mean, fag. Flag.
I didn't open this link, but right under the Chexting report,
yes.
Mm-hmm. The state has dropped charges against adult fetish models accused of animal cruelty. Jesus.
No.
What made you not click on it?
You know, it was in very fine print.
Does Chexting have to do with no. animals?
No, they don't have thumbs.
No, these are just the other stories, you know. These are just... Bond has been reduced for the woman who drove her kids into the ocean. Let me ask a question. Why would you reduce a bail on someone who is insane, an insane murderer of her own children? Why would you reduce the bond? Who would do that?
Because it's a little too much, you know?
Really? Now, a judge has denied bond for the jailed girlfriend of her slain police officer boyfriend. Okay.
Why? You should always have bond.
That's what I'm saying.
Should always be able to get bond.
Yeah.
I always wanted to be like, you know, super millionaire, you know, guy, and then like somebody commits a heinous crime and they say the bond is like $5 million. I'm going to let him out, you know, just like, you know, you're bombed and you go, yeah, I'm going to take care of that guy. Let him out. Come on, party with me.
I am going to read a list of the links that I opened, and I'm going to look, and I swear to everything I hold holy, out of these six links, this link is included in these six. And generally, the links kind of match up. But another link got in there that does not belong. See if you can pick out the one that doesn't belong. Are you ready?
Mm-hmm.
The one I just read you. Dr. Greer, psychologist, says that sexting can be a more insidious form of infidelity. I clicked on that.
Mm-hmm.
State drops charges against adult fetish models accused of animal cruelty.
Mm-hmm.
Police in Central Florida probe a middle school murder plot.
Ooh.
Bond reduced for women who drove kids into the ocean. Judge denies bond for jailed girlfriend of slain police officer. Representative Wasserman Schultz to host free small business workshop on Saturday. Why would they put Wasserman Schultz free small business workshop in the middle of the most horrifying links you could ever open?
Because it's probably a Republican-run paper.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. All right. Let's welcome our next guest, Brad James. Brad, welcome to the show. How are you?
Hey, how are you doing today, Jay?
I'm very, very good. Brad, let me apologize to you. I had a lot to drink last night, and I was doing a lot of stuff. I only thought we had one guest. You're on here now, and here's what's crazy. I could not guess what you do. I couldn't even guess. I apologize.
Here's a hint. Of
no problem. Would you believe me if I said I'm running for president?
Oh,
wow. Now, I pick the guest, right, Christina? But I forget who they are a lot of times.
Yeah, well, you pick the guest.
Yeah.
You can yes or no, but sometimes they're sent to us from listeners.
Right. Right.
Right. Does this ring a bell at all or no?
No. You know what? A listener said, so I haven't read about Brad a lot. Look, I am so, and I'm going to do this right now. We're going to take a break.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to kind of find out who you are.
You're
going to
do a little cramming.
Right away. Okay. I'm sure Christina sent me everything, I'm not having a person on here. We had a guy coming in there making drinks one day, and I had no idea he was coming in. I'm going to make sure I know who you are, and in the next 2.5 or 3 minutes when we come back, it'll be a whole different interview. Brad James, is that what you're doing? You're running for president?
Oh, actually, I'm the singing truck driver that's taking the internet by storm.
Oh.
Wait a second.
Yes.
I do know who you are. Wow. You're that Brad James?
Yes, I am.
I'm lying through my fucking teeth. We'll be right back.
I know.
Jay Thomas Show. Every day something new, something bizarre. For you, for now. The Afternoon Drive Show on Indy.
Sirius XM 104.
And on the Sirius XM app for smartphones.
I know exactly who Brad Davis is now. Or excuse me, Brad James is now.
Yeah. All right,
let's listen.
And it cost me 99 on a prison farm in Georgia, just north of the Florida line.
Yeah.
Well, I've been here for 2 long years, and I finally made the warden my friend. So he sentenced me to a life of ease, taking care of old Red.
So Brad James is the singing truck driver, and I was sent information. We have a lot of, you know, I believe that 75% of the people that have Sirius XM are either traveling salesmen, people that ride 50 miles to work or whatever, or they're over the road, you know, truckers. And a lot of people sit at their offices with computers and listen to everything else, but really, you're working and it's difficult. And so somebody said you need to have Brad James, or Brad, that's how you came on, a fan of yours out there.
Was
or
that,
your wife.
Was that Brad singing right there?
Yeah, that was you, Brad.
What? Oh, my God, that's fabulous.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So, Now, what's crazy is that you put your singing on YouTube, and you had, like, what, 11, 12,000 followers, right?
Last night, my Facebook following just passed over 20,000 last night.
Wow.
Yeah.
Now, you have a trained, almost have a trained, I mean, it's a country voice,
that's
but it's
more
trained.
Than you, Jay.
Way more than me. Were you a trained singer as a kid, or did you sing in the church or something? No.
I sang in my church youth choir when I was a kid, but I've never really had any formal training.
Mm-hmm. You got a big voice.
Well, thank you.
Kevin, it doesn't sound like for fun. If you told me that you were opening for Travis Tritt or you were opening for somebody, I would believe them. I'm not joking.
I would too. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, well, thank you.
Now, do you think there are a lot of guys out there that have voices as good as yours? Is there that much competition that's unsigned?
I think so.
I don't know. I'm gonna find out in Dallas because they're having a trucker's talent search, which I'm gonna be participating in.
Fantastic!
And so,
we're
gonna be finding out the other singing truck drivers out there, and then gonna put it to the test there.
When is that gonna happen?
What are you gonna wear?
That is August the 21st.
That's very important what he's going to wear, okay?
Quiet, please. Quiet. Okay, let him answer.
He's got to wear something nice.
Hold on a second. Hold on a minute.
Go ahead.
Before you do it in August, I want you to come back on. And, Christina, you were saying that you need to get him on the Trucker Channel.
Yeah.
I am going to be talking
to Who are those
Noah
two people that moved over from
Freewheeling
PBS?
Chris T and Meredith Oakes on Road Dog
right.
128.
They came over from PBS and they're on the Road Dog channel. I don't think they fit in. Yeah, they were both on. They were public radio people. I don't think they belong on that channel. But that's none of my business.
You've never
two pseudo intellectual liberals on the Raw Dog channel. I don't think so.
No,
do you, Brad?
Raw Dog Road.
I mean Road Dog. Road Dog. Road Dog's even tougher than Raw Dog, right? So now you're married, you got four boys, you sing in the truck. Where do you record that? It's amazing. Did you record that, like, into your computer?
No, I do it all on my iPhone. I record the audio and the video all on my iPhone.
In the truck?
In the truck.
Jesus. And now how do people find you? They go, what, hashtag Brad James?
I still haven't figured out Twitter, so they can look me up. You find me on Twitter, maybe, but they can go on my Facebook page, Brad James Facebook page. Mm-hmm. I've got my personal page and my music page, I've got my website, www.brad-james.com,
mm-hmm.
And then I've got my YouTube channel where I've got over 100 songs posted that I've done.
Brad James. He's lives in Atlanta, mm-hmm. Georgia.
No, not in Atlanta.
Okay, so it's not you.
Oh, boy. Brad James.
You're not black, right?
No, I'm not.
Okay, not black.
Now, wait a minute now. So you're just mixed up in there with all kind of other Brad Jameses. You got to do something.
Brad James Singer. I'll put that in there.
There you go. Put Brad James. No, it's singing truck driver.
Facebook.com/DaytonaBrad. You can find him.
Singing truck driver. That's singing, what you mean. Now, do you pull the truck up and all the other truckers pull their trucks up and then you get out in, or is it Dallas or Houston? Where are you going? Houston?
No, this is in Dallas.
Dallas. And you all pull your trucks up and then you go into a big venue and you start singing? How's that going to work?
Well, I entered a video. They're going to actually start judging here tomorrow, I believe it is. Tomorrow or the day after. And then they choose three of us to all go to Dallas to compete in a sing-off contest, I guess.
What do you think your odds of winning are?
He's going to win.
Really? Okay.
Pretty good if you go by the popular vote.
Because, what about sitting on the dock of the bay?
The detention song, Sitting on the Dock All Day?
Yeah. No, didn't you sing Singing on the Dock of the Bay? Sitting on the Dock of the Bay?
Well, I sang it to Otis Redding, Sitting on the Dock of the Bay.
No, he said...
It's actually a truck driver-related song that's
okay.
Sitting at the dock all day.
Oh, my God.
Which happens to be what I'm doing right now. So,
how do you not know that he doesn't sing Sitting on the Dock of the Bay? It's a trucker thing where they sit and
wait
for the stuff to... Yes, they wait for their load to be unloaded. Good God Almighty.
Okay.
You know, certain people come on and you should just back up and let a man handle it.
No, you...
Yeah.
You're not man.
Can we hear that song?
Christina,
can we hear that song where he's waiting with the truck? This speaks to all truck drivers. Brad James, the singing truck driver, is here. Yeah. Let's listen to it a little bit. Christina, please. My God.
I can't find it.
What do you mean you can't find it?
Nothing to live
for. It's his big song. How can you not find his big song? Huh?
Live trucking. How about live trucking?
While we're waiting for Brad James' song.
Can I just talk to Brad for a second?
Sure, go ahead.
Brad, is it on your website?
Yes, it is on my website. It's called Detention.
Oh, it's called Detention. Not 18 Detention. Wheels and a Dozen Roses? Oh, we already heard that one. I like
that's
that.
A good one.
Yeah, that's a good one.
That's a good one. Wow.
18 wheels and a dozen roses.
Where are you right now, Brad? What are you carrying? What are you trucking?
I'm unloading bottled water at the Food Lion Distribution Center in Dunn, North Carolina.
Now, you don't lift anything, do you?
Not if I can't help it.
Right. So you just pull it up and then you pick your teeth and you sing while the guys in the back unload stuff.
Yeah.
Pretty much, yeah.
Did they ever hear you singing in the movies? What would happen is they would put down their boxes and they'd come and they'd surround your cab. That's how the movie would present how great you were.
Well, yeah. I appreciate it. I don't think.
And then when you finish singing, you wouldn't even realize all of these big, tough, you know, moving guys had surrounded the cab. And then you'd finish your last note and you'd look up from your iPhone. They would all be clapping around the cab. Oh, yeah, that's how the movie's going to go.
I just joined his Facebook gang. I am part of the Brad James Facebook family.
You're going to start getting some of the most disgusting pornography you've ever received.
That is
on your Facebook.
Untrue. Just because I'm gay doesn't mean that I'm going to be sending him bad
Once
things.
Once they realize you're a part of that crew, Brad's done. Let's go. Let's listen to Brad James, the singing truck driver, please. Here we go. Right from the truck. Fresh from the truck.
He's sitting in the truck in this video.
Yeah.
Sitting in the truck. He's in the truck sitting.
Sitting in the morning sun. I'll be sitting when the evening comes.
Sing it, baby.
Watching other trucks roll in. Then I watch them roll away again. I've been back up to this dock all day. Watching the other trucks roll away. I've been sitting at the dock all day, just wasting time. I left my home in Georgia, headed for the Frisco Bay.
'Cause I've got freight to deliver. Looks like nothing's gonna go my way. I've been sitting at the dock all day, just watching the other trucks roll away. I've been sitting at the dock all day, just wasting time. Looks
wow.
like nothing's gonna change.
In the truck.
That dock light still remains the same. I can't do what dispatch wants me to do.
Oh, nice.
So I guess I'll just make them pay. Sitting here with dispatch on hold. Lord, you know that this shit's getting old.
This could be wow. a Broadway show.
I love 2 million miles I've roamed just to make this truck my home. I've been back to the dock all day, just watching the other trucks roll away. I've been sitting at the dock all day,
hey.
Wasting time.
What I can't believe is you're imparting all of that emotion and you're just sitting in your truck doing this?
And hey, I see what it took off, and I still can't whistle, so.
Wow. You sound
that
terrific,
was
and then
amazing. That was really,
really good.
Good.
Yeah, that was nice.
You'll come back on in August. Again? Yeah, you'll come in August, and then now if you know if you make it big, you realize the wife can't make the trip. You know that, right?
Okay, I won't tell her.
No, we don't know. You won't tell
listen
her.
To this either.
No, she'll just read about you and you know who would go off with him, Christina? Which one of those country girls would want to, you know, ruin his marriage?
Lovelace.
No.
Patty Lovelace.
No, we need a singer. We need a singer. Who would it be?
Oh, I don't know.
Tammy Wynette.
Yeah.
Taylor Swift. I don't know.
Taylor Swift.
I don't know.
No, you know what? I think that once she hears you, I believe that Nicole Kidman will leave Keith Urban
Ooh.
For you. Yeah, that's
Ooh,
what I'm thinking. Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah.
She's a little, yep. I feel like she's boring, though.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, good luck. Brad, we'll talk to you soon.
Katy Perry.
No. No, you don't want her. No. You'll get something from her. You'll catch something from her. All right, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. She couldn't keep that comic happy. They were done in a month.
Who was that?
Katy Perry married the English comic,
oh,
and they were finished in 4 weeks.
Russell Brand, yeah.
4 weeks.
And they went back and forth with each other.
That
like
was
ping
contentious,
pong.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was back, yeah. Yeah, they're just both crazy. It's got nothing to do with whether or not she can keep him happy.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, really?
He's
Oh, really?
Yes, really.
Oh, really?
Do you pay attention to
really?
the interviews and stuff? Yeah, it's not all about her. He had his own problems, too.
After 4 weeks, what's the deal, okay?
What was your shortest marriage, Jay?
3 months.
3 months?
3 months.
I was 36 hours. When I told her, my lawyer said, call her and tell her that you no longer want to cohabitate together.
How did you know and in 36 hours? How did you know?
Well, I didn't know her. So I had met her in
Wasn't
Vegas.
Wasn't this just to like be like, I'm not gay, I'm married?
Yeah, that was one of the reasons there. I was in Vegas and I got married because I didn't want anybody to think I was gay.
Wow.
So I got married before I was 40.
Why didn't you just leave the country and then just be, you know, like a dancing gay guy like in Sweden? Or
I'm just going to dance around the world?
Well,
just
I mean,
gonna
you
going to go
could...
to another country and just start dancing? What are you talking about?
You would go to the other country, you would learn the language, and you'd become a comedian in English and in Swedish or Norwegian.
How can I do that? Can't even speak English.
Well, everything is possible. We've seen it.
Yes.
And you say to your little girl, you go, look, you're not going to understand this now, but in about 6 years, you'll understand.
Oh,
and then
she
6 years from now.
Fine.
No, wait, no, no, no. Well, you are the biggest Swedish-American comedian up there in the, you know, in the whatever it is, in those Scandinavian
countries.
Again,
you're delusional and you make no sense. No. Okay.
And
you've been delusional. Ladies and gentlemen. You've been delusional all day.
Ladies and gentlemen.
I feel like he's on something. The comedy. I don't understand why we can't reel it
in. Ladies and gentlemen, he really the comedy
is. He's crazy.
Of Kavanmina. Kavanmina. And you come out and you go, ah, the Fusens and Fathers. Oh, we no big pond, Papa. We no big man, big pond, Papa. Yeah. You'd have been hysterical.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I've got to get back to writing my manifesto.
Unbelievable.
Right in the middle of it.
Mm-hmm.
Coming along great.
This comes from Bobby.
Bobby, dear Jay, can you hear me?
I enjoy your show. You can be an asshole sometimes. I am a loader operator, and I work at a rock crusher 6 days a week, 12 hours a day.
Wow. Crushing
rocks.
Oh, my
God. I enjoy Christina's laugh.
Mm-hmm.
Garrett is a fucking idiot. Kevin is all right.
Okay. Thanks,
wow.
Thanks.
But what's amazing to me is he works on a rock crusher.
Yeah.
12 hours a day. I'll tell you, I
bet
I'm
he gets
sure
headaches.
I'm sure you have a family and you have a reason why you have to work 6 days a week on a rock crusher. I will tell you this, and I'm going to be truly honest.
Be honest, Jeff.
If I were you, there would be that day where I'm
crushing rocks.
On the rock crusher, you know.
Yep.
And the wife and the kids are back home, whatever the deal is.
Yes.
And the whistle blows and the time
it's
ends
like Fred
or whatever.
Flintstone.
Yes, just like it. Hey, Fred, where you going, Fred? Where you going? And you would climb out of the rock crusher and you would walk with your lunch pail into your Ram Charger, whatever the truck is.
Wearing your muumuu.
No. Wearing your outfit.
It's like a,
and you would
Fred
get into
Stone
it.
Moo-moo.
This would be me.
Okay.
And they would never see or hear of me again.
You would just leave, disappear.
Yes.
Yes.
That's when people tell me of a job, and I could tell you didn't like your job because you said, you know, you're not going to starve. At some point, and I don't know, you know how it happens, but you just got in a fix, and you just have to get out of it.
And
just
the best
walk
place
away.
To kind of, you know, disappear would probably be in Louisiana, wouldn't it, Jay?
No, you don't. No. You just go, and you'll
cry.
No, but
it's an easy place to disappear, though.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. But you'll cry. You'll, you know, lay in your bed at night. Your family won't know what's going on, but you won't be crushing rocks 12 hours a day, 6 days a week. I think the sixth day is the worst day. Don't you think so, Kevin? Working 5 days, you can make it. It's got to be shit to get up on Saturday and have to crush rocks for 12 days.
I think 6 days is fine. I think, Yes, I think working 6 days a week is perfect.
I work 7 days a week right now, and it's not perfect at all. My life is miserable. There's no quality of life.
You know
You're just
what?
Living to work.
That's fine.
No, it's not.
Fine. If I were you, one day we would just not know where you are.
Mm-hmm.
Good idea.
Where's Christina today?
Don't know.
Gone. But you have no husband or children.
I know.
So you're free to do it, and you don't do it. All you say is how shitty your life is, and I'm gonna.
Is wonderful. I'm talking about the part of it is wonderful, but I'm talking about
what part of it's wonderful.
Well, I work here. I'm doing what I want to do, but not.
I told
not
you to marry
weekend.
Somebody so someone takes care of you
and have somebody take care of me. I am an independent woman, Jay.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
I do it on my own.
How's that working?
You're married.
How's that independent?
I'm struggling, but it's working for me.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
You're gonna.